We'll call this meeting to order. This is the October 17th meeting of the Ella Springs Village Council. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Wintrow.
Here.
Hausch.
Here.
Sims.
Here.
McQueen.
Here.
Hempfling.
Here.
Also present are Village Manager Patty Bates, Assistant Village Manager Melissa Van Zant, Chief Dave Hale, Village Solicitor Chris Connard, and Village Planner Denise Swinger.
Thank you. Announcements. I go to Brian first, of course, because he always has plenty.
Well, I first of all wanted to mention that the Little Art Theater is having Four Shingles Short come into town on October 27th. They're doing a Celtic Halloween concert, and it's going to be really cool. Also, we know that Halloween's coming up, and under Patty's guidance, it's always on October 31st, just so there's no question. So that will be on Monday. And Patty, we sanctioned 6 to 8 for Halloween.
That's
is that correct?
That is correct.
Very exciting is next Friday, October 28th, Home Inc., Yellow Springs Home Inc., is going to have an open house for the 4th Cemetery Street property. And that is actually, photos start at 3:30, and the open house is at 4:30, and there's going to be a chili dinner with the program at 5:15.
Sounds great. Any other announcements?
Yes, I have a couple.
Okay.
I got a request from a citizen today who drives through town rather early when children are going to school. And she was very concerned with the number of children biking and some of the biking habits of the children and what they were wearing. So part of the announcement is just people who are driving cars, watch out for kids. If any kids are listening, just pay attention to using your bike safely. And I will say something to Steve Kahn to see if the schools can do something.
Well, I think the gentlemen who were here last week, Chris Bongiorno,
yes,
especially, is doing a lot with bicycling in the schools. So maybe it's time. I mean, Dave, maybe an officer can set up something with the schools.
Yeah, another great thing to do is the Bulldog News, because all of our elementary school students watch that every morning. So
I see that all the time. The kids wear very dark clothing,
yeah,
and no lights on their bikes, and it is scary. If you're paying attention, you're not necessarily expecting it, and certainly, you know, making sure you're following the lanes and the rules and whatever. So good job. Good.
Okay. And then tomorrow evening, the Environmental Commission is having a brainstorming session to get ideas for our community, climate action plan. So the climate action plan is something that will be looking at what the village government can do to lower our greenhouse gases and what our citizens can do in their homes, to a certain extent, maybe in businesses, and more broadly than just CO2 emissions, but looking at things like being able to work and live in town, not driving a car, using local food, different kind of things that impact our carbon footprint. So that is tomorrow evening. It will start at 5:45. And I'm not sure if we'll be in here or in A and B. It sort of depends on how many.
Yeah.
We haven't made that.
Well, A B would be better since you're serving food.
Okay.
And
okay, so we're going to be meeting in room A and B at 5:45, 5:45 tomorrow. It'll be about a 2-hour meeting. And anyone is welcome to come who has any ideas they'd like to share, or if they'd just like to hang out and hear what people have to say. So this is sort of the first step in gathering input for that.
Thanks, Marianne.
Yeah.
Well, I did
Jerry?
Have one. Yeah. Now that, you know, Xenia Avenue has been repaved and so forth, the pavement is black now. And before it was a lighter gray, and you could see people and pedestrians, especially at night. With the darkness of the pavement, your headlights aren't reflecting like they used to off of the pavement, and I've noticed, and these are more adults now riding bikes with no lights on them, and it's and it's getting darker earlier. So we all just have to be more cautious, you know, until the pavement starts to wear down and we get that reflection again. Because we can't turn our bright lights on, but your regular lights just aren't bouncing off the pavement like it used to. So we're thankful that Xenia Avenue was redone, but it does create somewhat of a hazard at night.
I was going to say, especially out the end of town.
Yes.
Because when you're coming into town, all of a sudden the street is black, and it's very hard to see.
And actually, were you going to say?
No, go ahead.
There were two more things I wanted to mention. Sorry. I think everyone knows that this past Saturday, we had the 8th annual Yellow Spring Zombie Walk. And I think it's really important because there was a post yesterday about the fact that this event raised $1,000 for Yellow Springs Home, Inc. and our Bryan Center, Youth Center. And also, they gathered 7 tubs of food for the pantry. And I don't know. I just think that's so amazing that the village supports that. So I want to thank our village staff for, you know, putting out that effort. And also Toby Reed and her team for doing such a great job. And the other thing I wanted to mention, and I guess I'd love for this to be highlighted in the news, is I keep on seeing sort of misinformation about the electric charging stations. And I just want to remind folks that the monthly electric fee for those two charging stations is what, $11.48?
The first month that they were in operation, it was right around $11.
Okay.
Total usage.
Have you checked it since?
I have not checked it recently.
It hasn't been billed yet.
Okay. It would take $20 per unit for us to be able to meter them per month. So we would have to spend $40 a month to meter them and recognize revenue, but we're only spending 11 or 12.
And that's on both chargers?
That's the total.
Okay.
Yes.
And then I understand that you mentioned that one of our meetings, that they're fairly actively used.
They seem to be, yeah. Every time I go by, there's at least one and usually two cars in them.
Right.
And then they're posted on websites,
right,
that people refer to who are traveling looking for charging stations.
So somebody's coming from Columbus, they know there's a charging station in Yellow Springs. And on average, it takes at least a couple hours to get any kind of charge. So obviously, they're doing something for those couple hours. And so it's a great economic driver for the village, not to mention that it really, we're sort of walking the talk as far as what we care about in terms of going green, thinking about reducing our carbon footprint. So I guess I just want to emphasize, and I think it would be great for the facts about these charging stations to really be out there, because it's a boon for the village, and I'm really glad that we got them installed.
Great. Thanks, Brian. Moving on to the consent agenda, we have the minutes of October 3rd regular meeting. There were some minor, essentially typos fixed.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, did you send those out to council?
I did. I sent them out electronically.
Okay.
So that you would know that those were the minutes that you are
approving
to approve,
right,
or whatever.
And we also have the September financials. Can I get a motion to approve?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Next is a review of the agenda. We have quite a few pieces of legislation. Some of them are second reading, so those should go a little bit faster. Is there anything else? We also have a special report and some old business and one piece of new business, and then our board and commission reports. Anything we want to move around or add to the agenda?
So, you know, I wanted to raise the green space fund. Is that discussion?
That would be during the budget, when we hear the budget ordinance. Oh, no, not we're not hearing the ordinance. That would be during the budget discussion. We can, so
okay.
That's.
Well, part of the problem is I was linking our thinking about that to my vote on the extension of utilities. So I don't know if there's a way to fix that. I can
Well, there won't, until we vote on the budget, it's not final anyway, until it goes through two readings. So if you're linking your vote to that, you've got to think about how you want to handle it. And I'm sorry, because I know we talked about it, and I thought it, I forgot about the fact that we had the review of the full budget. I was thinking we actually had the budget ordinance on tonight.
But she's tying it to this.
I understand that, but until the budget is finalized. I mean, I would talk about what you want to talk about during that discussion. So anything else as far as the agenda is concerned? I will say that if we go past 9 o'clock in the meeting, I'd like to make it a standing idea that we take a 5-minute break at around 9.
Or 7 minutes? What our council rules say?
Yeah, maybe. So Brian, do you want to review the petitions and communications?
Yes. So we received a correspondence from Anita and Joseph Kohler about two things. One related to utility bills and a suggestion that we extend the time to basically recover costs for the water plant. And secondly, their support for extending utilities out to the land formerly known as the CBE. Secondly, we got a very nice note from Pat DeWeese complimenting Susan Gartner and the fact that she's very engaged in these meetings and really trying to make the viewer experience on Channel 5 meaningful. And remember, you can always watch our council meetings on YouTube on demand for free. And then Judith Hempfling also submitted a letter related to the point that, Judith, you just raised. And maybe this is a time to, if you would rather say a few words about that letter?
Yeah.
Okay. So basically this letter highlighted the idea that this decision to extend utilities to the CBE and thinking about economic development, that we also want to be conscious of protecting our Jacoby Greenbelt. And so we'll talk more about that later. And we did get a couple other things that weren't on the agenda. On October 22nd, NAMI is supporting a mental health awareness tattoo rally. And I'm guessing those tattoos may be temporary.
No, they are not.
Are they real?
They are real.
Oh, sorry. Oh, okay.
Is it the semicolon?
It's the ribbon, green ribbon.
Oh.
And the other one says hope, I think.
Okay.
I think the ribbon says hope, or you can just get the word hope, I think.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. And there are photo ops when you get those tattoos, so that sounds like a cool event. And on November 3rd, the Miami Valley Regional Planning Commission is having a meeting to highlight some of their proposed new transportation projects. And both of those, if you want more information, are in the packet, or you could always call us for information. Okay.
Thank you. Moving on to public hearings and legislation, second reading and public hearing of Ordinance 2016-22. Let's just read it in by title only.
Okay, this is approving the right-of-way vacation request to vacate one alley off of West Limestone Street.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay, our planner is here, Denise Swinger. Would you please kind of take us through this ordinance?
Yes, Charlene Prestipino and Carl Champney are here. They're the property owners of 340 South High Street. They're requesting the vacation of an unused portion of their alley located along the back of their property line. It has an entrance on West Limestone Street. Because they own a partial lot on the other side of that alley, it's become problematic for them with setbacks, and they have an old barn that is non-conforming with our new code, and it's very close to the Limestone Street road. So they want to take that down and build a new structure further back. And so they're asking for that. There is a shed that actually straddles that alley. It's just not an alley that has been in use as long as they can remember as well. And they're both here tonight if they have any comments.
Okay. Any comments or questions for Denise from council? This is a public hearing. I will open the public hearing to hear citizen comments on this ordinance. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes, Hausch.
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Hempfling?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Next is ordinance 2016-24.
Right, by title only?
Yes.
And we're leaving this, correct? Yes. We're leaving as is, Patty?
Yes.
Okay. This is repealing section 414.02 of the codified ordinances of the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and enacting new section 414.02 regarding the placement of stop signs on High Street at Whiteman Street.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Patty, talk about this proposal for a, well, it's more than a proposal, ordinance for a new stop sign.
If council remembers, a couple of months ago, we had a young woman named Chaya Fields come and ask that we add a stop sign. She requested on High Street at Davis to slow down the traffic. However, Chief Hale went out and observed the area and suggested that we put it at Whiteman Street, on High Street at Whiteman Street, to slow down the traffic because there's a several block length there on High Street where there is no stop sign. So this is the second reading of the ordinance that puts a stop sign north and southbound on High Street at Whiteman.
Okay. Thank you. Any comments or questions from council? This is a public hearing. Citizen comments? Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. Hempfling?
Yes.
McQueen?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Okay, ordinance 2016-26. I don't think I even had that in here.
That is not being read.
Okay.
We pulled it for the next, we were not quite ready with that one.
Oh, thank you.
Okay. So we're going to resolution 2016-51.
Right, 2016-51, yes.
All right, and this...
And just read this in full. It's a short one.
All right, this is authorizing the village manager to issue a request for proposals for the completion of the Dayton Yellow Springs Road infrastructure project. Whereas the village desires to extend the water and wastewater infrastructure from the corner of Dayton Yellow Springs Road approximately 1,000 feet west to the entrance to the Education Village property, and whereas the village has successfully negotiated with the Army Corps of Engineers to reduce the scope of the project grant to include only this portion of the infrastructure, and whereas this project is now ready to be advertised for proposals and completion, now therefore be it resolved by the Council for the Village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, that Section 1, the village manager is authorized to advertise the request for proposals. Section 2, such responses shall be brought to Council in a timely manner. And Section 3, this resolution shall go into effect at the earliest period allowed by law.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Well, this is this was brought back onto the agenda. We decided at the last meeting that we would bring it back to the agenda. We have kind of examined this property and this proposal from a number of ways. Krista McGaw was at the last meeting talking about the Jacoby Greenbelt and what extending this infrastructure from the center line of East Enon Road down to the access entrance to the Center for Business and Education, what ramifications that might have on development further west. And I think it was kind of determined that it was hard to say, but that it probably wouldn't have a significant impact. And that this is property that had been talked about for years for commercial development as it is. So I appreciated Krista's proposal. We did talk about, as a council, about what we could do to strengthen our green space fund and also to strengthen how we were approaching the green space and protecting the Jacoby Greenbelt. Judith, do you want to comment on?
I guess I want to apologize. When we were having the discussion at the last council meeting, I had said early on I wanted to link this to a commitment to increase funding of our green space fund. And then later in the last meeting, it was recommended that the money, and we had talked about, but we had not committed to, the idea of putting the monies that came from the Sutton Farm into the green space fund. And then later at the last meeting, the recommendation was to, well, there wasn't any final decision certainly, but there was kind of the idea of not putting so much money into the green space fund at this time and not putting that money into the green space fund. No decision was definitely made, but that was kind of the way the discussion was going. I kind of spaced out at that point and didn't think about the fact that if we had this resolution here tonight, we would not have made a decision by that point about how we're going to do, how we're going to be funding green space this year. And so I'm feeling like we should table this until we make that commitment, whatever that commitment is. So I'm not going to make that motion right this minute, but that's what I'm thinking at this time is the one way that we can ensure the linking of preservation of the Jacoby Greenbelt and moving forward with this infrastructure.
Okay. But you're not making that motion?
I'm not making it yet. Okay. Going to listen to a little bit more of the discussion.
Other comments from council?
Well, I mean, I definitely think that focusing on the Jacoby Greenbelt is critical. I don't know that, I mean, I'm not sure how you want to link it to this particular issue. What my understanding was that, Krista's here, so this is helpful. I mean, we don't know when the opportunity will come up. So there are different ways of dealing with it. One is to actually use the general fund if we need to, or maybe Krista even suggested that we could take out a loan, or I think I saw that in the minutes. So I guess I'm not sure how we would link it, but if I were going to make a sort of a mandatory linkage, I would do it as part of starting to work on the CBE, or even maybe before we start doing anything about the CBE, as opposed to extending the utilities, because I would like to just get this thing moving. And in terms of using money from the Sutton Farm, well, we can talk about that. I mean, we could put it in the green space fund, or we could put half of it in the green space fund and use half of it for the staff quarters. But I mean, the idea of maybe having some kind of, I don't know if it would be a formal resolution, that if necessary, we would take money out of the general fund if an opportunity arose during this coming year.
I understand also what Judith is saying. I'm leaning more toward as we evaluate all the land that we now own, that we tie that to the green fund, you know, because we do have parcels of land that we don't use and we probably can get rid of. And to me, doing that and putting it in the green space fund, to me, would be the ideal thing to do. And whether it be the Sutton Farm or any other pieces of property that me and Patty have been looking at the various pieces of property that we have, and I'm not sure that we'll be able to bring it forward in this calendar year, but definitely by the beginning of the next calendar year, that we'd have something put together, and to me that would be the perfect place for those funds to go, because we are abandoning land that we own, and to me putting it in the green fund would really speak about our commitment to the green fund, you know. So that's kind of the way I read it when you had mentioned the Sutton Farm, that just turned the light bulb on to me to say, let's look at all our land, and as we dispose of it, that's where it should go. So that's my take on it.
I think that the, I think, and if we're not to the budget yet, I don't want to talk a lot about the budget, but you can see things have been added to the budget. So the budget is not looking quite as, it's looking a little bit more red than it was when we looked at it last. So there are issues with the budget. I don't think it's not horrible, but it's not as rosy as it was. One way or the other, I mean, first of all, nothing's gone through in the Sutton Farm yet. I mean, and we really, I don't know when that's going to happen. I don't know how soon we're going to know that. So even with that, we're kind of betting on something that we don't know if it's going to happen. One way or the other, it's got to come out of the Green Space Fund. And I think we've got to commit to the pool, or to doing the crew quarters. I mean, we've been talking about that for 10 years or more. And so I really feel like we have to commit to that. Melissa did include that in the budget. So to me, whether it comes from the sale of the Sutton Farm or the general fund, is neither here nor there. It's really the same pile of money. I think that, one of the reason to not put it into the Green Space Fund is because once it's in the Green Space Fund, it's there. We can't remove it from the Green Space Fund. And I know that's what appeals to you because, in 2018, when there's a new council, if there wouldn't be the will on council at that point to support the Green Space Fund, then, we could, there maybe more money wouldn't be going into it. So I understand your concern. I'm kind of on the fence about it as far as whether we do it now or later. I don't know how much we're talking about, but I appreciate what Mary Ann said, that she doesn't necessarily see that being tied to this particular vote as much as perhaps tied to discussions going forward.
And just to play devil's advocate, I mean, even if it's in the Green Space Fund, if that future council didn't have the will, it doesn't mean they're going to spend it on this.
True.
But I love the idea of, in this next, as soon as possible, making this commitment. And I don't imagine a council in the future that wouldn't, support that either. I guess what I would like to know is, we have this new summary, and also I would like to understand, if we voted yes for this resolution tonight, what the timeline looks like.
Do you want to
What's going to
yeah,
happen?
Why don't we hear Melissa's report?
Yeah. Okay, so.
I'd like to say one other thing about, apropos to the green space. I think I'm interested in what kind of money we would be needing in order to grab a piece of property. And I think, I'm not asking that question right now, but I think it would be important for us to know, do we need $500,000, $1 million, a quarter, what would make sense for, say, a key property? And I don't know whether that would be under real estate, under executive session.
I would think that the initial discussion would be an executive session discussion. Chris?
If you're talking about acquiring land, that's a permitted reason for executive session because it has to go into cost strategies.
I mean, and it is somewhat sensitive because, and one of the things that I'm concerned about is if we have too much money in that fund, that's potentially automatically going to drive the price up, and is it going to discourage partnerships, community partnerships, and partnerships from people that, the kind of thing that happened with Whitehall when it was everybody came on, everybody was involved in donating to that. So I think that at the end of the day, The bulk of this probably will be handled by the village, but it would be nice for it to be a little bit broader community effort. I've also realized that we're talking about zoning township zoning, and we need to be, we probably should be talking to the township. We should probably have a joint meeting with the township sometime soon. I know that we talked about, when we start to get into this planning process, that will involve the township, but, you know, a lot of this depends upon what township zoning is for that property and what is allowed there. And so we could be worried about something that just couldn't happen anyway. So as far as a lot of, I mean, I don't expect that there would be a lot of commercial development going farther west, or if any, I wouldn't expect any commercial development. So let's pull back. Let's go to Melissa. I know Melissa and Denise spent quite a bit of time pulling together some information.
Okay, so I just want to back up to just kind of restate why my interest even began with anything related to the CBE, and it was because when I first started in December of 2013, I was immediately going through an audit. And there were three grant funds that were associated with the Center for Business and Education. There was one from ODOT, there was one from Ohio Public Works Commission, and there was one from the Army Corps of Engineers. One of them, I think, had, all three of them had had figures in the fund balances, and one of them was negative. And it's, you know, against audit practice to have a negative fund balance. So the way that I started work on this, along with Denise, who had the most institutional knowledge of any of the project, because she was here during the time that a lot of this was going on, and as you all know, we had different finance director, village manager, planner. There were a lot of different people that were no longer here. So I relied on her heavily to try to figure out what happened, why was this negative, and tried to put the accounting back together. So we spent a lot of time backtracking to try to get it cleaned up so that the last 2 years we did get a clean audit. So I got it figured out to, you know, down to the best that I could do with what I had because there were bits and pieces of information just everywhere. And one of the things that Denise and I had kind of wondered is why the original grant agreement was, you know, that it was everything, all the expenditures were going to be paid for 100% by the village until the 25% match was met, and then everything would be 100% reimbursable. Because that's a very odd agreement. And even when we were having conversations with the Army Corps of Engineers representatives that we're working with currently, they said that that kind of agreement would never happen anymore. So it was very interesting to us how that even happened and why it happened. And so we did know that Community Resources had given a check to the village in the amount of $42,000 for the village to spend down as part of the match. And so the notion of where did this $42,000 come from? Why did it need to be spent down? I mean, we knew why it needed to be spent down to meet the match, but it was just, there were still gaps in why this happened the way that it did. So Denise and I, on literally Thursday, sat down and we started looking at this. And there was a number of documents that we ended up not having in our access necessarily, but were able to locate through some pretty interesting means. But the document that started it is Exhibit A, which is a document called Financing Plan Financial Capability Analysis for the Center for Business and Education. And it makes reference to a 25% match requirement for the USACE grant. And it says a local nonprofit, the Morgan Family Foundation, also awarded grant monies to Yellow Springs Community Resources to be used as the required match funds for the USACE grant. But none of our documentation, which was piecemeal, that we had indicated how much that grant could have been for, and we had nothing on it. So in the village's transition over to the new website, we were finding that there was a lot of things missing on our own website. So I forget who it was that had told me, well, there's a website out there that you can plug any website into, and it will show you snapshots in time from past versions of that particular website. So when Denise and I were sitting together, I said, let me see if I can find an old version of the Morgan Family Foundation's website, because there was nothing that went as far back as what we thought it needed to be on their current website. So we started to look back, and I found a snapshot of the Morgan Family Foundation's website from 2008, which is Exhibit B in the packet that I gave. And listed were the competitive grants approved for fiscal year 2006. And on that list at the bottom, number 26 was, it says Yellow Springs Community Resources, Yellow Springs, Ohio, $175,000 to match a federal utility grant and for startup costs for the Center for Business and Education. So we thought, well, this is interesting. So then we called the Morgan Family Foundation, and I didn't have this at the time that I put this information together for the packet, but we found the grant agreement, the original grant agreement, dated October 27th, 2006, from the Morgan Family Foundation to Yellow Springs Community Resources, and it outlined the amount, $175,000, to be used as a match for a federal utility grant and for startup costs for the Center for Business and Education. So then when we started looking at some of the things that we had and putting all of this together, we found that Community Resources was awarded the grant by the Morgan Family Foundation. They spent down, I believe, which is Exhibit C, they spent down nearly $107,000 worth of expenditures on the CBE. So these were organizations and firms that they had hired for all kinds of different things that are all listed in that exhibit. And then it appears, which I'm not really sure why, that after that $107,000 was spent, for some reason, the remaining $42,000 was handed over to the village. And so it was 149. Yeah, 149,000 was the original 25% match. So the $42,000 that was remaining to be spent down on that original grant agreement match, a check was written to the village in 2007, which is Exhibit D, where it shows that it was receipted in our old finance software. And it was put into Fund 351, which was one of the funds that I originally started to look at that, you know, had issues with it because it was associated with the Center for Business and Education when I started. So if you look at Exhibit E, this is a list of all of our funds, and the OPWC and the ODOT grant are no longer there because those have been zeroed out and they've been audited, and so I don't show you things that are no longer relevant. I hide them, because we don't need to draw attention to them necessarily because they're inactive. So as you see, we have grant fund number 351, which is circled, and we've got, as of my accounting, $17,967.31 left in this account, which would have been the remainder of that $42,000 check that was handed over to us from Community Resources. So then in the final exhibit, which is Exhibit F, and I know that this is information overload, but it all ties together and it, I feel like, is very useful. Exhibit F is the is a document that the Army Corps of Engineers gave us to show us how reimbursements would be calculated based on what's already been spent and what would still be spent with construction if this project moves forward, and what the village's share would be and what we would be set to be reimbursed if all goes as planned, which, you know, some of these figures could change because some of them are estimates. So if you look down at the very bottom line, we would be set, if we move forward with this project and we spent the estimated $260,000 in construction, we would be set to be reimbursed for $343,853.35. They would deduct the administrative costs from the Corps of Engineers off the top of that, which is $71,115.28. Part of that has already been incurred, $51,115.28, which is a lot more than what was originally anticipated. But then again, this grant has obviously been in progress for much longer than what anybody ever thought it would be. So when we had to kind of go back and recreate everything and reacclimate everybody with what had happened and how we move forward, even before the reduced scope, there were administrative costs that were involved in that. And then we will have further administrative costs that will be associated in moving forward, which are anticipated to be about $20,000. So at the end of all of this, if we move forward and expend $260,000, we would be set to receive $272,738.07. So the village would spend $260,000, which we do have nearly $18,000 in that fund, so we could deduct that from those costs. And the village would get back $272,000. So we put in $260,000, we get back $272,000. We're getting an extra $12,000 coming back to us when we're only spending $260,000 because the root of all of the match money was a grant from Morgan Family Foundation to Community Resources. So that's a very long explanation, but we literally found this on Thursday and started to find information any way that we could because it was so old and we did not have it in front of us. And so we thought that it would be good to share that with council tonight since this is very relevant. So I will take any questions if anybody has any.
Good work. That's a lot of, that was a lot of digging.
Yeah, both you and Denise, you know, to do it in one, sounds like you did it in one day.
It literally took us about 2 or 3 hours. We made a couple of phone calls, checked a couple of archived websites, and ended up being able to pull it together just from a question of why. So,
and then Brian, did you want me to answer your timeline?
Yes.
Question. The timeline, as of if it stands right now, if you pass the resolution tonight, I could let it tomorrow. It has to be out there for about 3 weeks, and you have to review the bid, so that's a month. Council has to pass a resolution in December to let it. I don't see, unless the weather holds greatly, I don't see it being constructed until the spring when the weather breaks.
Okay.
At this point.
So what, March, April?
If the weather breaks in March, I'm sure they'd get started right away, yeah.
So would your plan, but that would be your plan. I mean, to move forward that way, if there was a contract, they could begin if
yes.
the weather was favorable or...
Yes.
And we could potentially get favorable pricing since we're hitting it early.
Yes. Usually if you get it out early, you get a little bit more favorable pricing because they've not bid on all the other jobs that will come out in the spring yet. So they want something they can start with.
That they can rely on.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I would like to suggest that if council that council maybe with Krista, you know, basically the council commit to trying to get a better sense of what it's going to what some kind of a plan, some kind of a concrete plan in terms of preservation of the Jacoby Greenbelt. You know what, and that go in hand in hand with the discussion. That we're going to be having about the CBE, that public process. Just to say, my main, you know, I obviously want to see the facilities for the staff to be done. What I had understood, and it sounded like, Karen, you're saying the numbers aren't as good as they were the last meeting, because I had understood we had a four-month, $1.1 million in the general fund, and that the money's actually we're going to be somewhere around $1.9 million. So it sounded like there was there was enough money there.
It's quite a bit lower.
Okay. I appreciate what Jerry has said about the idea that as we're thinking about the lands that the village has, and one of those would be the glass farm, as we're thinking about potential housing development out there, that there will be an income stream coming, you know, from there, for example, potentially, some income. But I would like, my concern is that there have been councils that have not had the, well, you know, things come up. Yes, I would like the money to be protected in the Green Space Fund. And I feel like we've got the political will. We're basically promising citizens that if we go, that we can go forward with this, you know, plan with this CBE land and also, you know, do our best to, you know, preserve the Jacoby Greenbelt and meet that commitment that we've always had as part of our land planning. So I think if Krista's willing to maybe work with us to try to figure out what is the number that we should be having in our green space fund that can put us in a very strong position, you know, then I feel comfortable going forward with this vote.
Krista, would you possibly be ready to meet with us in executive session at the next meeting? That would be November 7th. And we'll decide if that will be, is there a particular time? I would assume you would probably prefer maybe a 6:30, a before executive session than a who knows when after.
Yeah, I think that's probably good. Let me get back to you for sure, because we actually have a meeting scheduled at 6:30 that day. So I'll follow up.
Okay.
I can do that in the next couple of days.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Does that sound like something council's
coming Yeah, forward? I mean, I think that that's the first step. I think then, you know, then we'll learn what we can in executive session, since it is real estate, and then, and it's not even just for us, it's for the privacy of property owners, too. Then, you know, come back to, then further discussions can happen in open session.
I guess I'd just like to say that I think there are probably more options than just the Green Space Fund. And so when we're looking at properties, I think I'd like to throw the net a little wider. There might be people that would be willing to provide a personal loan, for example, for some amount of money. I mean, there might be other sources.
Oh, absolutely. This will not be able to be the only source, I'm sure.
Right. So, and maybe that's, and I don't, some of that discussion wouldn't specifically be executive session discussion. It would just be the real estate, but maybe you could provide us with some strategies. I think we talked about it at the last meeting. Some of the strategies that we might be able to use beyond simply saying, give us some money. Mm-hmm. So, are we ready to take a vote on this?
Okay. Citizen.
Oh, sorry, citizen. Dawn, go ahead.
Dawn Johnson, 234 North High. I have a question. Has the property been transferred yet?
No, it hasn't. We are still waiting on some documents from Community Resources that our attorney has requested. Some older signed documents that they're having, they're trying to get them together for the title company. So,
and when the appraisal was made, was the covenant brought forth as part of the appraisal?
I believe it was, but I would have to double check that to be sure.
Okay.
Do you remember?
I honestly can't remember.
I would like to know that, because that covenant is 14 pages of a very specific criteria that, as Mr. Kennard said, that it would go with the property, and it has at least 20 more years, and it renews every 10 years. So that would have quite an effect, I would think, on the value of the property one way or the other. So could you find that out, please?
I can tell you that the title insurance, that the covenant is addressed in there. In other words, that there's an acknowledgement, there's a covenant on the property.
Right. I'm talking about the appraisal value of the land. The land was appraised for a particular amount if it were sewered, and another amount if it were not. And I wondered if the covenant was a part of that appraisal process.
And Don, why do you think the value, the appraisal value is important in, for this decision?
Why do I think it's important? Mm-hmm. Because we as the village are taking something in lieu of forgiving a loan of $300,000. And I want to, I think the village should know that whether or not for certain that covenant affects the value of the property.
But what does that have to do with the decision to use the grant?
It doesn't.
To,
I'm okay. Just, this is my opportunity to talk about this.
I'm just trying to understand what, right. So you,
it's
you,
just
okay.
My opportunity to talk about the property in general and the value of the land as it sits with the covenant or without. If you have an opportunity to have the covenant dissolved, for instance, let's say the covenant does create a negative value on the land and you can have that covenant dissolved, you should probably do that before it's transferred. That's what I'm thinking.
So it's relevant to the transfer decision.
I think it
decision.
Is. Okay. I think it's relevant to the value of the land.
Right, which is not what we're talking about.
But we don't know
right
because you're gonna find out whether or not the appraiser was aware of the covenant when they made the appraisal.
Right. I think it's quite complicated though because as you say, it's a 20-page covenant. It's not something we're going to get through. It's not something we're going to be able to parse through in a very short period of time. And I would be concerned with simply dissolving it because there were promises made when in those covenants as to the type of development that would be there that I would be concerned that we abandon. I wanted to be clear that we're not supporting retail development and that we're not supporting certain types of development at that property.
And you don't trust that our zoning will do such?
I don't know. Don, I don't know. I mean, I think it's...
I'm just asking. I know that you, at the Green County
Chris,
Planning Commission...
how important do you think these covenants are? First of all, I don't think that they're that important to the value. I mean, to whether we take the land or not. I mean, the value of that land is more than $300,000, whether as agriculture, as farmland, it's worth $300,000.
But maybe not 640, or maybe more.
Well,
maybe
but,
more.
But
who knows?
Nobody's investing $640,000 in it.
But that was brought to the council is that the land is worth so much more with utilities there. That's what's important here. That comes back to this. So, thank you for your time. Think about this, please.
Thanks. Any other comments, questions? Okay. We'll take the vote. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Same sign. Okay. Resolution 2016-52. Let's just read this in by title only and then Patty can just explain it.
All right, this is authorizing the village manager to enter into a lease with Stony Creek Garden Center for village-owned property located at 4550 U.S. 68 North.
Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Patty, would you talk about this, please?
Absolutely. I received a letter from Stephen Karen Reed at the Stony Creek Garden Center. Currently, their lease runs through December 31st of 2017. However, they did a customer survey, and the survey indicated in the feedback that one of the things that their customers would like to see is a more comfortable indoor shopping experience. And as a result of that, they would like to put a removable structure on their property or on our property. And you can see some examples of some of those things. Example A in the exhibit is an example of the building they're talking about. In addition to that, they'd like to put a small welcome center display out at the front with maybe a couple of banners that allow them to draw some attention to the entrance to the Stony Creek Garden Center because it is kind of hidden back in the back. But they are hesitant to make the investment into these improvements without an extension on their lease. So they have requested that their lease be extended for 2 years past its current date. That would mean it would expire December 31st of 2019. And after review, the staff does recommend that we allow them the extension on their lease so that they can make these investments into their business, which seems to be growing by leaps and bounds, so.
And just to reiterate the building, because the building, the example that they show is quite a substantial building.
Mm-hmm.
But what they're actually proposing is a temporary structure, removable.
They call it a removable building, yes. So it would look like this, something nice and palatable that fits in with the aesthetic out there. But at the same time, if it needs to be removed, it can be.
And have they checked with township zoning?
They have not checked with the township zoning, but it will be their responsibility to do so and to abide by any zoning regulations that are in place.
Okay. I would say that with the new agritourism zoning, that this would fit perfectly within the agritourism
mm-hmm.
zoning.
Mm-hmm.
Any other comments or questions?
Yeah, looking at it and, looking at what's there now, I think it'd be a nice addition to the northern entrance to the village.
Mm-hmm. And Patty, do you recall what the amount they're investing is, approximately?
I do not
okay.
recall that. I know they told me
I didn't
me
see
that
it in there. It's not in there,
but they did tell me, and I cannot remember off the top of my head.
I mean, they've done quite an excellent job. The place was really in rough shape, and they've worked for how many years have they been there? About two years.
Two and a half.
Well, it was Yellow Springs Botanicals before that. So
right.
and they were involved with that.
They were there
so
as well, yes.
It's been years now that they've been working to improve that property. It's a continuation of the use that it had for years under Gary Stutzman. So I like being able to support that business staying in town and growing. Any other comments?
I agree. I think it'll look great.
Any comments or questions from citizens? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 Resolution by 206-53.
This is authorizing the village manager to enter into a one-year contract with Dental Care Plus for dental insurance for village employees.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Patty?
This is our annual renewal for our dental care. We are seeing a 4% increase this year on our dental care, which is, considering the cost of it, is not huge. But it is a 4% increase. It takes an individual currently at $25.90 to $26.94, and a family plan is currently $75.11 and goes to $78.11.
Okay. Any questions or comments from council? Citizens? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
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 2016-54.
And I'll read this by title and let Melissa do the honors. This is authorizing payment of an invoice with a then and now certificate in the fourth quarter of 2016.
Okay. Can I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Melissa?
This is an invoice that the purchase order was not entered in prior to making the purchase. So this was an oversight by one of the superintendents. And so as promised when I started, you would see less of these, and hopefully there have been a lot less than what there
yeah.
used to be. So that is what this is. So basically what a then and now means is that a purchase was made before the purchase was certified with the finance office, which is basically a way of saying that the purchase was made before the actual purchase order was entered into the system. So that's what this is.
But the money was there, and
yes.
it was
mm-hmm.
it was a known purchase or part of the budget.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Any comments or questions from council? Citizens? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Now, Melissa, these next two pieces of legislation are unexpected. I think I'm going to actually have you explain them before we read the legislation.
Okay. So as part of the Safe Routes to School project, we have contracted with a consulting firm to do the right-of-way acquisition. And we are still on a very tight schedule in order to acquire right-of-way access for the project to occur. So all of the parcels that are involved, contact is being made by the consulting firm with all of those property owners. They had appraisals that were done on the portions of the property that we would need to have temporary easements on and access to during the construction. And so the appraisals were done and offers were sent out and made to each of the property owners. They had a window of time in which they were supposed to either negotiate with the consulting firm or agree to the terms that were presented to them, and then they would sign a document and they would return it back to the consulting firm, and then they were able to file that with ODOT in order to be able to move forward with the project. So there is one particular parcel or property that is in foreclosure, and so when they went through contacting all of the property owners and sending out certified letters and actually going to each of the properties and making contact with the property owners to you know, offer any explanation, they were unable at any point to reach the property owners of this particular property because they have vacated the property. So since we have not been able to gain contact with the property owners, in order to be able to stay within our time frame, we have to appropriate a temporary easement for this project in order to be able to keep it on track. So in order to do that, there are two pieces of legislation that need to happen, and we had to put them on the agenda tonight in order for them to be filed with the courts in a timely manner in order to be able to have the temporary easement granted in order for the construction not to be delayed. So Chris knows much more about the legal aspects of this than what I do, but basically this is the only property that we anticipate at this point is going to have such action by council or legislation involved. So it's because it's in foreclosure. So this is not something that's typical or that other people might expect to occur with their property in this project.
Council questions, do we want to, any questions of the solicitor or Melissa?
Well, just in looking at the resolution, so the parties named in section two are the folks that are in foreclosure and the who owns the
So we're ready to hear the legislation. We'll read them both in by title only. Judy, 2016-55.
Yep, this is the resolution declaring the necessity of an intention to acquire property interests owned by Jeffrey Kingsley, Melody Kingsley, and J.P. Morgan Chase Bank National Association with interest by others for the Safe Routes to School project in the village of Yellow Springs, Ohio.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
I think we just heard. Any other questions or discussion? Any comments from citizens? Seeing and hearing none. All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Now, next is actually an ordinance. It will be an emergency ordinance to keep with the schedule as Melissa described. Will you read that in by title only, please?
Yes, this is ordinance 2016-25, appropriating certain real property interests owned by Jeffrey Kingsley, Melody Kingsley, and J.P. Morgan Chase Bank National Association for the Safe Routes to School project in the village of Yellow Springs, Ohio, and declaring an emergency.
Thank you. Can I get a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Same thing here. I think we've already heard. This is a public hearing. I will open the floor for citizen comments. Seeing and hearing none, I'll bring it back to council table. Judy, would you please call the roll?
Yes. McQueen?
Yes.
Hausch?
Yes.
Nemfling?
Yes.
Sims?
Yes.
Wintrow?
Yes. Okay, thank you. We got through a lot of...
So before we leave this topic, though, so I just want to be clear on, so everyone else has signed off on the right-of-way?
Not everyone has signed. I think that there are one or two properties where there were a few issues that are still being kind of hashed out, but we don't have any reason to believe that we won't get signatures from everybody, but we've gotten most of them, so it's still in process, but there's some negotiations happening with some individuals because there were just questions raised about trees or fences and things like that, and being looked at and plans being updated to kind of accommodate some of those things, so that's where we're at.
So the purchasing of the right-of-ways, that money is coming from the grant?
ODOT, mm-hmm, correct.
And I would just like to take a minute to thank Melissa. She has worked diligently on this project. When she accepted the assistant village manager position, I said, guess what, you have a construction project. And she was like, okay. But she has done a great job on it and has been very complicated. So I just wanted to give her kudos and thanks for that.
Thank you. Yes, a lot of work. I wonder if you're going to be interested in going for any more safe routes to school money.
We'll see when it's
in the
over,
future.
Right?
I'm sure Brian's looking
I'm interested.
For some. Now is the point in the agenda where we hear from citizens about items that are not on the agenda. Dawn?
I'm Dawn Johnson. Ohio's falling behind the important task of weaning ourselves off of fossil fuels. A few years ago, the State House passed legislation that froze Ohio's renewable energy and efficiency standards that were promulgated in 2008. Just when the freeze is about to sunset, there are several bills floating through the State House right now that will extend the freeze until 2019. Our environment is changing before our very eyes. We cannot wait to require our energy providers to adjust their energy portfolio. I know and appreciate that Yellow Springs is doing its part voluntarily increasing our clean energy portfolio, leading by example. Mothers Out Front Yellow Springs plans to meet with Rick Perales at the end of the month to discuss the need to take action immediately and change the ratio of fossil to clean fuels used in power production here in the state of Ohio. And I encourage council to send Representative Perales and Senator Burke a resolution supporting the sunset of the provision of the current freeze. Thank you.
Thanks. Can I ask you a question, Dawn? Because I believe that actually Governor Kasich might actually not support the freeze, lifting. He wants the freeze to be lifted, is my understanding.
I've heard that too, but I think it's incumbent upon us to let our legislators
absolutely.
Know that we encourage the sunset of that particular.
Is this
freeze.
Veto-proof? Do you know if I mean, I think we should probably include the governor, though. I mean, I absolutely agree with you.
Yes.
But if he is looking to support.
Then we would support his action
right,
to
yes.
veto. But I don't know that it's veto-proof.
Okay. Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
And thanks for the recommendation. I'm glad he's coming back. Is he coming back for another meeting?
The 28th.
Okay.
I believe we'll be meeting maybe here at the Bryan Center.
Okay.
Who, you know, what, is it a group?
Mothers Out Front. It's a group that's recently started. It's headed by Laura Skidmore, who's a township resident. But there are several of us who've come together recently just with an overwhelming, you know, acknowledgement that our children's lives are going to be so radically different than our own, and if we don't do something immediately, I mean, it's pretty dire.
Right.
I mean, we're already past the 350 parts per million of CO2 in the atmosphere now. So, yeah.
Thanks.
And Don, one other thing. So I think it's a great idea for council to send a letter. Mm-hmm. Is your group sending letters to all state legislators?
I don't know that we're sending them to all state legislators. I believe we're focusing on the legislators that serve our communities.
All right. Well, I would recommend sending them to everybody.
All around.
I mean, that's what we did with the Clean Ohio Fund, you know, to get that reappropriated. So.
And you can do it via email. All of the email addresses
right.
are on the website. Krista probably has them all on a list. I'm guessing. But yeah, that'd be great.
Thank you.
What is our timetable on this?
It sunsets at the end of the year.
Okay. Okay. So that gives us what?
Well, I'm, you know, what I'm wondering, when does the Energy Board meet again, Judith?
We just had our meeting last week. But the meeting, I don't know, that's a...
Climate Action Plan.
The Climate Action Plan meeting, maybe the Climate Action Plan group could...
Yeah, I mean, what, it would just be nice to have some language.
Oh, okay.
To have somebody help us draft something, so...
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I would say...
I would be for us doing it.
Resolution or letter. Resolutions tend to have a little bit more weight to elected officials, so that would be good.
So we should bring it back for the next meeting? And maybe the mothers out front could help provide some language also?
Yeah.
Okay, that'd be great.
Can you, Don, can you email me just a summary of what you just presented, and I'll bring it up tomorrow night?
Okay, sounds good.
Thanks. Any other comments for citizens? Krista?
Thanks to Don for bringing that up. That it's so important. I happen to also be on the board of the Ohio Environmental Council. That if you do need any help or want to make connections with colleagues across the state, I'm sure they would love to hear from you. This was a piece of legislation that actually was creating jobs in Ohio. And it just was an amazing turnaround to put that legislation on hold. It's really, really sad. Mm-hmm. And I'm not sure what's going to happen. Governor Kasich has threatened to veto it, but that's not clear. So it's tremendously important, and it's important for our economy too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Ohio was doing well at job development. So it was a real sad loss.
Hmm.
I'm here because I did a little more research after last week, like Melissa. And I actually went back to our legislation from council in 2010 to just kind of look at what was put in place at that point. We had talked about a minimum fund at that point, or at least a minimum fund of $250,000 being in place. I haven't updated that for today's, you know, market. I'm looking forward to talking to you in a couple weeks and getting that research together. But just to say, at that point, council passed a policy we were very excited about to put estate taxes that came back to the village into that fund up to the point of $250,000 as a matter of routine. And that triumph was short-lived.
Yes.
Governor Kasich was
first
elected.
Year. I mean, I think it was the year we did it.
And in that year ended the estate tax. But I just wanted to weigh in just as a follow-up to what I was saying a couple of weeks ago, is that a lot of what I was really trying to do was to kind of go back into the history a little bit and give you an update. But that was one piece that I kind of left out. And so it just, it's somewhat germane to the conversation you had earlier, too. I mean, my recommendation would be at least to keep consistent with that commitment as you look at, you know, Sutton Farm or general revenue, or, you know, as you look forward for the budget. Because I think that we don't need less than then, you know, but I think that that was a decent start. Because under ordinary circumstances with most of those parcels, if indeed we can work with a willing landowner to purchase an easement, and they are willing to take 2 years to do that, to complete that transaction, which is really the circumstance under which we operate for the most part, then we've got, that's enough money for us very likely to be able to leverage federal or state funds to make that possible. So just to bring that piece back, I realize I did not come across that, and I thought, well, what the heck, I believe we already did kind of cross that bridge at one point, and since you're starting to have some budget discussions, I'd like to just kind of weigh in on that I thought that was a good idea. And we'll be updating numbers too, and talk about if there were a sales situation, what would possible approaches be for that. But just for the ordinary way we do business now, I would highly recommend that level of $250,000.
Great. Thanks, Krista. Anyone else? Okay.
I just wanted to say, when Dawn had spoken earlier about the CBE land, so I just wanted to be sure I think that is interesting and important information to kind of know, you know exactly what we're talking about as we're finalizing that.
Actually, Patty has some information on that, of the covenants.
Dino actually is apparently watching at home.
Oh.
And he texted me and told me that, in fact, the covenants were considered as part of the appraisal, and let me just read it. The covenants do follow, and we had the appraisal done with that in mind, is what he said.
Oh, cool. Thank you. Next item on the agenda is a special report on Indigenous Peoples Day. I think I'll turn it over to Mary Ann first to set the stage for the speaker.
Okay.
Thank you.
So the Human Relations Commission for a number of months this year has been considering some way of creating a celebration, which probably would be called Indigenous Peoples Day. And we had had Guy Jones from the Miami Valley Native American Council come and talk to us. And then Kate Hamilton, who's here, had contacted Summer. And Summer McGuire, sitting over there, came to HRC the last meeting and really gave a really inspiring presentation, I think. And this is something she's been passionate about. So I invited her to come to council. It's a sort of a week after the so-called Columbus Day, but it's still timely. So Summer, would you come up and tell us about your research and what you suggest?
Sure. So as Mary Ann said, my name's Summer McGuire. Grew up here in town. Moved here in the mid-80s, so back then I was Summer Peters. At any rate, I wanted to first of all thank Council for the time to share a little bit about my personal connection to the holiday, and to thank Kate and Mary Ann for their ongoing work with the HRC around this issue. Honestly, I was a little surprised that it wasn't on the books already, just because of who we are as a village and our progressive values and our history, right? We've got this long-standing, beautiful tradition of civil rights work and of justice work in the community. So as I'm sure many of you are aware, this has been a bit of a hot issue in the last year or so. We have 9 different cities across the country that have transferred their observance from Columbus Day to Indigenous Peoples Day. We've got Denver, Seattle, Phoenix, and there's like 6 other ones that all transformed their holidays and their celebrations a year ago this October. So Cincinnati proposed some legislation. You probably heard about that as well. Unfortunately, it was voted down, but the work continues there, so they're not deterred, and I'm optimistic that they'll be able to get it done so we can steal their thunder, so we can totally capitalize on the moment and get the dialogue going. And I think, honestly, it makes a lot of sense. You know, we have that adage that we all hold dear about being ashamed to die, and yet we have this person that's being celebrated who's, I think we can all agree, a pretty awful guy. I'm just going to throw out a little bit of my own background. I'm the vice president of the League of United Latin American Citizens, or LULAC. It's an 87-year-old civil rights organization in the country with councils all over. So we've got a Dayton council. I'm active there. There's also a newly formed group you guys might have heard, the Beloved Community Project of Yellow Springs. And I've been asked to sit on the board of directors for that as the director for social justice work. So outside of names and titles and things of that nature, the work runs deep with me. I was brought up to make a difference, either make a living or make a difference, is what my mom said. And she said, if you can do both, that's the goal. So we take being actively engaged in our community very seriously. In grade school, I didn't really learn a lot about who my people were. My mom's from Puerto Rico, and the Indigenous peoples of Puerto Rico are the Taino people. So I really rarely heard about Latino history and achievements and accomplishments growing up in school and history classes. And then similarly, heard little about my Indigenous side of my heritage. And then as I got deeper into high school, where the curriculum was a little more robust, and certainly in college, I learned really just a vast amount of information and was pretty shocked when I came to understand what Columbus and his men had actually done and what they had directly been involved in. And honestly, my first reaction was, was anger at feeling lied to, really, by my teachers, and feeling disappointed by an education system that was supposed to nurture and shape and mold me. And then also just frustrated because it's hard enough to form your own sense of identity in general, but as a young woman of color, to have my people's traditions and history really ripped away from me, and then even like whitewashed over. Like when they talked about the Taino in conjunction with Columbus, they were like a footnote. Like there were some people there, they were somehow extinct, end of story. So come to understand these folks aren't extinct. There's actually folks with ancestry and even full blood lineage surviving today. So it's just this great effort to try to raise awareness and to get the history out there. And what that does for communities when they're celebrated, when they're recognized, when they're validated is tremendous. I can tell you when I got that sense of who my ancestors were personally, the transformation was profound. So when we talk about Columbus, in my mind, there's kind of a sense of, well, it wasn't that bad, and he was a product of his times and kind of things of that nature. I wanted to give some statistics. This is from an article by Bill Bigelow on the Howard Zinn Project website, which is a great resource. I'm sure Marianne has that resource and Kate has that resource to share. I'll send an email with a few other links of the Transform Columbus Day site and some others. So basically, he initiated the transatlantic slave trade, right? So how he did that was he took several dozen Tainos and thought that he could ship them to Spain and tax those shipments, and he'd be able to make money for his supplies in the Indies. And so he intensified his efforts and gathered 1,600 Tainos and sent them across. He decided actually to keep just 550 of the best for that shipment, and then the remaining were kept there in the Indies, and he just offered them up. An announcement went around, according to one of the journals, that whoever wanted them could take as many as he pleased, and this was done. Well, it comes out to find out that the profitability wasn't there for the slave trade to Spain. But that didn't stop Columbus, and he wrote in his journals, "Let us, in the name of the Holy Trinity, go on sending all the slaves that can be sold." Later on, Basil Davidson, an eminent historian of Africa, went on to dub him as the father of the slave trade, which seems like a pretty big phrase and maybe a little bit of hyperbole, but honestly, the first license granted to send enslaved Africans to the Caribbean was issued by the King and Queen in 1501 during Columbus's rule in the Indies. So he had a direct hand in it. It's not just speculation. So once we look at slave trade and he didn't see the profitability was there, he moved to a tribute system. So it wasn't about discovery and, you know, cultural bonding and exchange and finding fascinating things about other people. It was about conquest and exploitation. So the tribute system worked like this. He forced Tainos 14 or older. I'm sure many people here have children, some maybe even around that same age. Picture your child being forced to fill a hawk's bell with gold every 3 months. And if they could fill that bell with gold, then they were good for 3 months. If they couldn't, hands were chopped off. They were chased down by attack dogs. In the circumstance of there being a skirmish, right, an actual outbreak of violence between the soldiers and the Tainos, if a Spanish soldier was killed, 100 Tainos were killed in response for that one Spanish life. And the methods that were used to carry out this punishment, you know, to carry out this execution, was one of the methods was burning them alive at the stake. And specifically, Columbus would group them together in groups of 13 in recognition of Jesus and the 12 apostles. So not only is he committing these horrible atrocities and these crimes against humanity, but he's also taking the Christian faith and twisting and warping it and using it in these atrociously oppressive ways. So it's just important, I think, that we understand, you know, the nature of the beast that we're dealing with. Bigelow goes on to talk about the implications of the holiday and what it means and what it says to a nation today. And he says, if indigenous people's lives mattered in our society, if black people's lives mattered in our society, it would be inconceivable that we would honor the father of the slave trade with a national holiday, which I think is pretty profound. You know, we've got two federal holidays for individuals, and we obviously recognize Dr. King and he's worthy, but then you've got this guy, and I just don't get it. So, you know, and when you look at, you know, it happened a long time ago, and why does it matter? Why do people still care? You know, why am I up here crying about, you know, what happened to my ancestors? Those actions set the precedent, right? It's linked right hand in hand with manifest destiny, and it set the foundation for legal and social policies that are still being carried out today in the United States, Mexico, Canada, South America, and many countries around the world, really. Those policies justify the theft and destruction of indigenous people's lands and knowledge by corporate and government interests. We really don't have to look too far, but just right across the way at the Standing Rock Reservation to see how these policies are being carried out today, where the people are fighting for their lands. They've got bulldozers coming and desecrating sacred lands and religious objects, all for the sake of a pipeline. So it's got very real modern-day implications, and the potential is there for us to have a hand in being on the right side of history and in helping to make the transformation. So I encourage council to consider the recommendation to transform the holiday from Columbus Day to Indigenous Peoples Day. Moreover, I'd like to see it become not just something on the books or that sits in a drawer and we know technically this is how we observe it, because I don't know that we really observe it much as Columbus Day right now, so then how would we observe it much as Indigenous Peoples Day? I know the Beloved Community Project of Yellow Springs is looking at working with Antioch College, and I know the Young People of Color organization had some interest in finding ways that we can create some actual observances around that day and make it, you know, have some meaning in the community. Perhaps a day of programming would happen at the college. I'd also like to see another piece of it be the curriculum piece. So I'd like to get a community of interested parents, obviously working closely with the administration, to look at what's being done in the curriculum today, because I know there's some great things that are working at the upper levels. And there's no doubt some areas for improvement in the elementary curriculum pieces that I've seen. My daughter's only in first grade, but I saw her hand out in kindergarten, and it was not great. It was just kind of the standard, you know, he was a great explorer, and it didn't really go into much. You cannot talk about genocide to five-year-olds. I'm not advocating that at all. You have to be age-appropriate. But my daughter's teacher this year actually invited me into the classroom to talk to the kids, and we used a very high-level example of, you know, if some new kids came in and they moved into your classroom and took your seats and took your things, you know, what would you think? Just talked about it in ways that they could perhaps relate to and understand a little bit better. And moreover, from just celebrating Columbus, the other pieces to talk about, if we're really looking at our history and about the formation of this country, the founding mothers and fathers are the indigenous peoples that were already here. So I'd like to be able to teach them, what were some of those folks' stories? What were their traditions? What were their achievements? What, you know, I used a really small example of, you know, who likes barbecue? And the kids are raising their hands. Who's been canoeing? The kids are raising their hands. Those are Taino words. That's part of the contributions, you know, small little examples. There's certainly more profound ones when you look at indigenous contributions across the Americas, but there were little ones to start getting their little gears turning. So to be able to talk to the kids in ways that help them understand, if we want to make a holiday about the formation of our country, then there's a way that we can do that still. And what could that look like? And then you're teaching kids the truth, right? So you don't have that feeling of betrayal or that, you know, being let down the road when they realize their teachers misled them. And just the sense of pride that you then put in the hearts and minds of the children who hold that history is a powerful bonus as well. So that's my hope, is that we can get that work going, and thank you for the time.
Thanks.
I have a question.
Sure.
What is the Beloved Community Project of Yellow Springs? I'm not aware of it.
It's a new nonprofit that's in its infancy. We haven't quite incorporated as a 501c3, but we're working on it. It's a multi-faith organization that's looking to bring awareness to a range of issues focusing on social justice and diversity. As well as interfaith dialogue and finding ways that we can get tapped into different issues that are going on in our community here, but then also connecting it with national movements and obviously working with current organizations doing similar like-minded justice and diversity work as well. So we've got a website, belovedys.org, as well as a Facebook page, Beloved Community of Yellow Springs. So please feel free to check it out, and I can also send information in that email to Mary Ann to share with the council as well. I have a short poem, which is about Columbus Day. Part of how I walk my social justice walk is as a poet, and so I'll share that in closing. It's called October 12th. I organized in Denver had the blessing of organizing for a number of years there. It's one of the largest demonstrations for Columbus Day in the country. I had no idea. I just happened to move there for grad school and then found out there was this community of folks that were actively transforming the holiday. And so the year I wrote this poem, we had gathered in the streets actually the year before, and 237 of us were arrested for nonviolently demonstrating and speaking truth to power. Because basically what we saw in the parade when Custer's, a recreation of Custer's cavalry led the parade in, and people would whip candy like weapons in children's faces, was that it was really a manifestation of hate speech. It wasn't really a celebration of cultural pride, but it was this this really a violent act that needed to be changed. And so there was lots of dialogue and education awareness, and it was hard, but eventually the work paid off. That year when 237 of us were arrested, the charges were dropped, and there was a discussion then that happened with the parade organizers, as well as the law enforcement and the folks in the Transform Columbus Day Alliance community, and the dialogue went from there and then paid off last year with the transformation of the holiday. So, October 12th, Columbus was no hero. I'm telling y'all it's true. We need to realize the filthy lies taught in far too many schools. I never heard of my Taino people, of their history, their dreams, and more. Instead, I was told of discovery, God, golden glory upon Borinquen's shore. Yes, I do remember, 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. Perhaps instead, here's how the song should end. He killed my ancestors. Did he kill yours too? My teacher spoke of some roots to spices, three ships and people somehow extinct. But why weren't we taught Columbus's true devices? Slavery, 13 burned at the stake, or would that just make us think? I recall that college classroom just a few years ago. Colonial Latin America and a classmate with an ass to show. They lost, we won. Survival of the fittest, nothing more, he said. The tactics ain't so fit to me. Soldiers killing children, smallpox blankets on little beds. Good old manifest destiny, it's a rope slung round my neck. But I shrug it off and hold aloft battles Custer would like to forget. Lands and homes were taken. They demonized traditional people. What made it worse, made hell on earth, took our ways and words and gave church and steeple. The Christians have their ways, but believe me, but we have our faith too. To them, belief and prayer guide them. Thousands of years of life, blessing and struggle, believe me, ours do too. So how is it all connected? Columbus's voyage and where we now stand. Our history is our history, including his trip to our land. But why should this man be honored? He brought much pain, much death, and greed. Here's the trade, our true past, for a parade. It's all related, Mitakuyasin indeed. Let's come to an understanding. This honoring holiday brings much pain. Come together in love and rise above. Transform it all like sun through rain. Thank you.
Thanks, Summer. It was really lovely and inspirational. So, Marianne, what's HRC's plans? Are you planning to bring a proposal, or what do you see as a next step here?
Yeah, well, first, thank you, Summer.
Yes.
What we are planning on is looking at some sample resolutions for celebrating, acknowledging Indigenous Peoples Day. We will do that at the next HRC meeting and then come to council after HRC has agreed on a resolution that we would like to recommend. So that would be the village government piece specifically, I think. Initially, we had talked about having different activities. I don't know whether that would come out of HRC, but it seems like there's some other groups that are interested in doing that for next year.
And does that also mean disacknowledging Columbus Day?
Well, Yellow Springs doesn't actually, the village government doesn't celebrate Columbus Day.
Right.
Now, we might decide we want to write a letter to, is it, so it's a national holiday?
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
yeah.
We could write a letter to the federal, I don't know who you write a letter to, president. I don't know. But we could write a letter saying, you know, that we would like to not have Columbus Day be a national holiday.
I'm suspecting it's one of those things that the schools probably acknowledge. I mean, there are a few national holidays that people don't get off work. Veterans Day is one. And so I'm sure that there is some acknowledgement in the schools, especially, I think. So
not Yellow Springs schools.
There's no closure. There's just like some.
Well, I know that nothing's closed. Yeah. I just meant that there may be some discussion about the day as a holiday. And maybe there isn't. I don't.
Yeah, I actually followed up, you know, with Principal Hausch about that, and it's definitely not
okay.
A supported holiday in the Yellow Springs school system.
Okay.
So, Well, I would support.
Was that a decision that was made, like, out of discussion, or is it just something that, do you know?
I don't know that, actually.
I do remember years ago when I was on the board, you know, in negotiations with the teachers' union and so forth, we would determine what, how they would actually celebrate. Columbus Day never came up in the discussion. But given that, you know, I think we as council, as a village, should take a stand and really support this. You know, I'm elderly, and, you know, I was taught about one method of slavery where the Africans were bought over, you know. And now to hear that, actually, it was before that, it sounds like, that, you know, Columbus did a deed and was strictly for wealth and was supported by many nations. So to me, you know, let's get out there and take a stand and let them know that Yellow Springs is interested in justice and letting history be told. So that's
my agree.
Position.
I agree.
Yep.
Well said.
So whatever HRC brings back, whenever that happens, we look forward to it. Thanks a lot, Summer.
Thanks, Summer.
Next item on the agenda is the former CBE planning process. We had started talking about that briefly at the last meeting about putting together something perhaps similar to the police forum that we did that would be a facilitated discussion with village mediation. Whether it would be that particular one was, you know, was small group. It started out as a large group, and then we broke up into small group sessions, which seemed to be pretty valuable at having perhaps a little bit more robust conversation within the small groups. So, you know, I don't know that we need to get specific, maybe just talk about time frame and you know, start to set out a process of what our next steps are going to be.
Well, I mean, did you guys talk about it the last meeting? It seemed that the Economic Sustainability Commission was interested and willing to, you know, coordinate that with the support of village mediation. And I thought that was a really good partnership when the HRC worked with village mediation. So that would be what I would recommend.
So have they talked about this?
We talked about it briefly, yeah. And I think that would be... that would be something that would be acceptable and that they would like to do.
I like the idea of breaking into small groups so everybody, you know, can have a chance to have, you know, say what they're thinking about.
Right. And what we did, you know, we started with the local policing forum in rooms A and B, and then we basically used every room in the Bryan Center.
And open space, too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep.
So lobby out here.
Right.
So.
And you gathered the input of people somehow. And
right. Yeah. Every group had a flip chart, and we brought that all back together. And then actually, ultimately, all that information was, you know, was all compiled. I think Patty actually still has the
probably somewhere.
The
yes,
big pages. So yeah. So we had something like 8 or 9 village mediators. So we were able to really do a nice job with around a dozen people in every group, so everyone got a chance to share.
I think that, I think this is a good idea. I would like to see a proposal come from the Economic Sustainability Commission to sort of outline, would there be some presentations first? What questions would people be asked? Would there be information presented to people, for example, what's in the covenants or what was already planned? Does that. But I also think that we might want to consider other processes. For example, not everyone in the village is going to come to this. So do we want to do some online
And actually...
What kind of venues can we have so that as many people who would want to be involved can be involved?
And that's a great point, because we also did do that with the local policing forum. Chrissy Cruz set up...
Oh, yeah, and we even put things...
Oh, we had the boxes, yeah, yeah. So we could do all that again. I thought it was a great process.
When are you thinking, like, the proposal would, I mean, would this be happening, like, February, March, something like that?
Well, so the ES, I mean, I think this should be at the top of the ESC's agenda for November. They meet the first Wednesday of the month. And then I would hope that we could have something to review at that second meeting, our second meeting in November. So... And again, we've got, you know, a format that we can start with, so it's not starting from scratch.
Okay. Maybe part of the discussion should be, what should we call that property? You have a contest.
I like CBE land, actually. I don't know why.
Well, yeah.
I like adding land to the end. CBE land.
I'm going to make a suggestion. We have two people here for one topic, and that's the... Ellis Park Beaver Management, that we move that up on the agenda. Sure.
Sure.
I gather, Karen, you're getting ready to signal to the next topic, am I
yes.
right? I didn't mean to interrupt if I was mistaken. Dan Reyes, I was hoping to speak briefly to the topic about a planning and visioning, or whatever we would want to call it, for the property that's in the process of transfer. And there, I know there was some discussion last time. There has been over these couple of meetings, and I apologize. I'm relying a little bit on minutes from last meeting rather than being here. But I think, Karen, you had raised a point last time about the anticipating some role of planning, or particularly planning expertise, in finding a way through this. And I had a sort of impulse to speak to that, because it seems like it's, on the one hand, I agree, but I think it's, there are a lot of different ways to go about that, potentially, and they may have very different sort of results as far as what you would run into. I mean, the thing, and we do have resources here. I guess, you know, even with the discussion that's going on tonight, it occurs to me we're talking about the Economic Sustainability Commission. I would hope the Planning Commission would be invited to participate. You know, the local people who've been active in land use and planning should, I think, be considered serious resources for this. But the other side of it is, you know, is there outside help that one looks to try to come up with a vision? And there may be a particular occasion for that, because this property and this project have gone around for a decade or more without finding a satisfactory resolution, right, that's been buildable and that's been able to get community support. So I wonder if there are some ways to consider seeking help outside of the boxes that we've been in so far. And the thing that I don't know that we've talked about, at least not in any meeting that I've had the opportunity to attend, is that we do have I don't want to suggest this is the only way, but we do have three, you know, within an hour of Yellow Springs, about an hour, hour 20 minutes, three professional schools of architecture and planning with some significant expertise on their faculties. One I know better than the others, the folks at Miami University, but I know there are people there who do urban geography and planning and community outreach as well, and who've done partnerships with communities before to try to help them solve problems that don't seem to be suited by ready-made solutions. So I wonder if those sort of conversations could be worth bringing up as this moves forward. I presume there'll be some steps between here and there, and there could be more than one sort of good contribution. But I'd like to, you know, I guess my hope has been that there'll be some new ideas that get put on the table as this goes along.
I think that this process that we're talking about is the first step, and it is being looked at as a way to start to get community input without expending funds, without hiring a consultant. So I think that something that you're talking about could very easily come out of this. But I just see this as the initial step, and that will just kind of give us a little bit of a roadmap for how to move forward. Isn't that, I mean, I don't know that I see this particular process we're talking about as being the last piece of the puzzle. And I think because of that, because it's more of a discussion, I don't know that we need that planning. I mean, I want Planning Commission to be there, and I obviously want, you know, people that are involved, but I'm not sure that we need a professional planner to be part of this initial discussion.
Okay. I wasn't suggesting that it's the first, you know, thing that's urgent necessarily on the list, but I did recall that it had come up or had been hinted at in some of the remarks in previous meetings, and I'm not remembering all the context that crisply myself, but I just wanted to suggest that there are some ways that we could possibly as a community extend the resources we make use of, and working with a public university could be a way to do it at a relatively low cost too. You know, if it's an opportunity to make an educational opportunity for them and a practical opportunity for the village.
Thanks, Dan.
Right.
Just a thought too, is that I think a lot of the issues around the CBE land is about people's connection with the land. So I think not just thinking about the economy, the economic questions or the planning questions, but the question of people's relationships to the land, I almost feel like, because it's such a beautiful entryway. I mean, all our entryways are beautiful, really, but that is a particularly beautiful one that I always come in, frequently come in through. And I think that's a lot of where people's feelings of concern and, you know, worry and, you know, what would feel acceptable out there, sort of. So I don't know how you get at that. It almost feels like more like poetry or something, you know, since we just heard that beautiful poem. And I don't know how we get at that, but I just kind of throw it out there as some piece of what seems to me is some kind of a part of, if there's an introduction, sort of that acknowledgement. And because I've been thinking, because the idea of planners and that sort of thing, if you're going to have businesses that are building out there and they need to build to their own need, we're not going to get to plan out the layout. I don't quite see how that would work. I shouldn't say we can't, but I don't quite see how that works. But I think it has something to do, a lot to do with kind of, like I say, that relationship and kind of the aesthetics, and that people don't feel confronted by something that doesn't fit there and that somehow.
Right.
You know, so well, I don't know. Well, it's a visual.
To that point, you know, what was, I think, really powerful about the local policing forum is that there wasn't a program so much as a, here's what we're going to do, let's break up, let's talk, and really facilitate, you know, as opposed to
make the space for people to say what's on their mind.
And I mean, that's what I envision.
And weren't there topics, were there topics within, or were the groups just broken up into?
Yeah, what happened was the facilitators, you know, sort of prioritized based on what the groups brought up. So it wasn't as directed, but each group brought up, you know, based on like their top five issues.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I'd like to see, but of course we can discuss it, you know, once we get that proposal. And I realize that ESC meeting's on November 2nd. So certainly, you know, Dan, Dawn, Kate, I mean, everyone's welcome. That's a public meeting. So we could actually review this on the 7th at our first November meeting.
Okay.
So, but that's what I'm envisioning. To me, giving it to the ESC is more, I mean, that's why we have commissions, to give us capacity, absolutely. But not to direct the agenda to just economic development.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I request that we do the Glass Farm.
Do the Glass Farm, then we'll do the Ellis Park, then we'll do the budget.
And I don't see it taking a long time.
Okay.
So one of our goals for this year was to start talking about housing development on the glass farm. And so I've talked with Patty Bates and with Karen about what might be first steps toward doing that. And Patty had mentioned that in relationship to the solar array, the company Terracon has done soil borings. And the soil borings indicate, well, I suppose the type of soil, but also where the bedrock is and the water table. So she was feeling and used that that would be an important first step for doing the whole glass farm, except for the wetlands area and for the solar panel.
Right, and the reason that I say that is because we did, the solar array site is just over 6 acres. We did 8 soil borings, and in those 8 soil borings in that small 6-acre spot, the water table ranges anywhere from 3 feet down to 18 feet down. Now, you can build if your water table's 18 feet down, but you can't build if your water table's 3 feet down. So I think that it's very important that we know exactly what we're talking about on that entire acreage so that we can have our conversations knowing that information, because you can't even really build on a slab with a water table at 3 feet. So Jerry's nodding his head down there, so I'm assuming he agrees, being a construction person. So I think it's important that we know where that water table is on the entire property that we're talking about. So Terracon, we put out bids when we did the solar array, and we got 3 back. And Terracon was the lowest. They did 8 soil borings for $6,650. To give you a general idea, obviously they wouldn't have to do that area again, but it's a very detailed analysis of the soil types, the water table depth, where the bedrock is, all of those things. So I just think it's important to have that piece of information if you're going to start discussing what you can potentially do with that property.
It makes sense, you know, because it could become mute. Mm-hmm. But see, I just hate to see us spend a whole lot of time saying, you know, doing this and that, and then come find out that, you know, the land won't support what we
right.
envision.
Well, I'm sure there's always a solution. Mm-hmm. there's a solution. So I mean, one way or the other, even I would guess that there could be some kind of a solution to the water table mm-hmm. issue too. We just need to know what
we need
that
to know
is.
What it is, right?
So are you proposing to that? I mean, that's a staff decision, really, that we can direct staff to do.
Right. Yeah, I think
it would certainly be under whatever your bid amount is, or whatever
my bid amount now is $30,000. So yeah, I think it's a very important piece of information to have during the discussion. So
I would agree.
Sounds good. We've also discussed a few other potential next steps, one of which would be a housing needs assessment. Another would be involving the community in looking at what the community feels housing needs would be, in particular around that space. There has even been a discussion about looking, Karen, I think you and I talked about looking at the whole northwest part of the village in terms of what kind of development might happen, because on the glass farm, on the CBE, and of course there are properties that we don't own as a village, but at some point will be available. So I'm not suggesting we talk about those now, but those seem to be some of the kind of next step kind of things that we would do. So my request at council for this meeting would be approve requesting staff to have the soil borings.
Are you making a motion?
I'm making that motion, yes.
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay.
It's 5 till 9. Let's go ahead and take our break a little early, and then we'll come back and we'll talk about the beaver, the glass farm beaver. Do you think that's going to take a long time?
I don't.
Let's go ahead and do that. Let's hit that one. Let's get that one.
Yeah.
So it's the Ellis Park beaver management issue.
Yes, 2 weeks ago, I get an email from Anna Bellisari, who is here to represent the tree committee, that we have beavers in Ellis Park, and said beavers are destroying the trees in the arboretum. Some of these trees are very large, and they have very, I mean, these are very large beavers. Their teeth marks are bigger than my fingers. So Jason and I went out and looked around, and there is a dam. There was a dam, because it's not there right now. The beavers were damming it up, and I guess continued to work on that project. I got a hold of Vicki and Mary Ann, Vicki Hennessy and Mary Ann, and they spent quite a bit of time out there wrapping the trees with fencing to prevent the beavers from doing any further damage. The problem that we have is, as my report explains, there are several problems. First of all, eliminating the beavers isn't really going to solve this problem, because you're probably just going to get more beaver back. So even though the village currently has a policy of cohabitation with the beavers, even if we were to take the steps to trap and eliminate the beavers, we would very likely get more back. The second problem that we have is that the drainage ditch is actually, they're in the drainage ditch, and the drainage ditch is actually maintained by the county. The county was going to plan on going out there and pulling out the dam this week, because it was backing it up. It's the drainage ditch from the farm fields, and it was backing it up. However, some of our police officers noticed it last night and decided that they would help, and they removed the dam last night.
A small section,
enough to let it flow. What we talked about, Anna and Vicki and myself and Rick Donahoe and Jason Hamby got together, and we would like to move ahead with putting a flow device in there. Not like the one that is at the glass farm, but one that is flatter and goes through just the bottom of the dam to allow the flow to continue. I'd like to take a minute now to let Anna speak, and then Vicki as well. I know Anna likes the beavers, but they are damaging the trees. So.
I'm Anna Bellisari, the president of the tree committee, and Dan Beverly is also a committee member, a longtime committee member. In fact, all of us are longtime committee members. Just curious, how many of you have ever been to the Ellis Park and the Lloyd Kennedy Arboretum? Oh, good. That's great. As you know, then, the Arboretum is a collection of special trees that we've labeled, and they're for the purpose of people to see what kind of trees you could grow and what they would look like as mature adults. We have about 150 trees in the Arboretum right now, and Lloyd Kennedy spoke to me today. As you know, he's going to be 102 years old on Wednesday. He's still keeping track of this. He said that his estimate is that each tree in the Arboretum is worth at least $500, and we've got 150 trees out there. So you can imagine the value of this property for the village. It's village property, but we, as a tree committee, small group of volunteers, is maintaining it. And we know that as trees grow, they become even more valuable. So this is a valuable asset for the village. It's also a beautiful place to visit for anybody who comes around. And unfortunately, some of the trees in the Arboretum are tribute trees, which means that someone has paid for the tree and has designated it as a tribute or as a memorial for someone. One of the trees that was killed was a tribute tree, a memorial tree, actually, and that was very sad to see that happen. As Patty said, I'm not interested in killing off beavers at all, and I've I think it's perfectly useless to try to do that. And unfortunately, we created this arboretum not realizing that there would be beavers in the future, and we've created a perfect habitat for them. Planting trees right beside a stream is temptation that beavers cannot resist. So it's kind of our fault that this has happened. But on the other hand, the tree committee are a group of people who have worked very hard. We plant trees there, we try to maintain the place as well as we can. We try to encourage people to visit it, and we're interested in maintaining and keeping the trees happy. So we need to figure out some way that we can protect those trees. If you haven't seen the damage that's been done, go out and look. Two hornbeams were killed. A pecan tree has been girdled, a huge mature pecan tree. Hazelnut bushes have been cut down. Pawpaw sprouts have been taken and put into the dam. And most sadly of all, the Schumard oak has been killed. And that was the one that was a memorial for someone. So I'm hoping that we'll figure out some way to handle this situation and save our trees. Thanks.
Thanks, Anna. Thanks. Vicki?
Well, I'm here to defend beavers. I am sympathetic to this, and I've been out there covering trees. I don't know, we must have covered, 50 or more trees with tall wire, and I just ordered some Ropel, which is a thing you paint on the tree trunks that's supposed to be really bitter and prevent beavers from chewing. But I don't have a real solution, but I did want to, I just wanted to say a few things about beavers and this particular predicament, and I guess why it's sort of to be expected. You know, back when we were talking about the early days of Columbus, but back when Europeans first came to this country, there was an estimated 200 million beavers that lived here. And as you might guess, the topography and the whole hydrology system was vastly different than today. It was wetlands everywhere and lots of species and lots of standing, holding water. I mean, if there was climate change today, we'd be in good shape if we'd left it like that. But unfortunately, around the time Europeans got here and started spreading across the U.S., it was stylish to have beaver hats. And so beaver pelts became very worthy. They were worth more than gold. So trapping began up in New York. It started and it spread westward. And by 1830, beavers were totally eliminated from the state of Ohio. And it only took them about 100 years or so to come back, but around 1947, there were said to be 100 beavers that had come back in from other surrounding states. 100 beaver across 11 counties. And by 78, there were, 1978, there were 10,000 beaver in Ohio. And 20 years later, in 98, there were 25,000 beavers in Ohio. And by 2004, there were 40,000 beavers in Ohio. So what we have right now, I imagine there's many more than 40,000, but what we're seeing is what's typical of populations that go into an area that they've left or that's open to them. Beavers aren't competing with too many other animals. You see these exponential growth curves. They call them J-shaped curves, where in a very short period of time, the population increases. But what generally happens among most mammals is that they don't keep doing that because they run out of resources. And beavers really respect their resources. If they're low on trees, which they won't be at the arboretum, if they're low on food, you know, their population soars and then it drops because they need resources to support them. So most populations undergo what's called the sigmoid curve. They grow rapidly, get to the carrying capacity or the amount of resources starts to run out, and then they level off in what's called an S-shaped curve. And that's typical of all the studies I've ever read about beavers, is that they follow this S-shaped curve. So my guess is, you know, they've been in exponential growth in Ohio, and they're probably just about ready to taper off.
But what's their territory? What's their territorial range, though, Vicki, because we've got a lot of trees in Yellow Springs. They're extremely
territorial, and they defend, like, along a waterway, they defend about a quarter of a mile, and other beaver won't come in there.
Right, but how far will they? How far will they go?
They, I mean,
they, so they went from the glass farm.
We don't know. Let me finish here. What I think is that because of this exponential growth and what we're seeing in the glen, well, along the Little Miami River, the entire watershed is filled with beavers. They're in John Bryant. You can see all the trees down. They're in the glen, the South Glen, way down 68. You find beaver along the Little Miami. They're in a lot of the tributaries. They're all over Massey's Creek. They're here in Yellow Springs Creek right behind us, in behind the houses on Cemetery Street. They see beaver often. They're in DeWine Pond. They're at the Glass Farm. And they're at Ellis Park now. But I wouldn't say it's the Glass Farm beavers that arrived at Ellis Park. As far as I know, the Glass Farm beavers are still at the Glass Farm.
So what's the solution? Because we're, you know, we can talk about the beavers all we want, but I don't think anybody's going to accept these trees being destroyed.
Okay,
so what's the solution?
I don't know the solution, but for me, what's happened since we started wrapping these trees with wire, they haven't touched a single tree. They touch the ones that are unwrapped and unprotected. And even though we have a lot down, we really don't. We have three trees down. One they cut completely down. Two, the hornbeam and the something else, are left, you know, chewed so that they have a little thing in the middle holding them up. So there were three trees that were irreparably damaged. There's one tree that, the pecan, that probably was damaged, but I wired it anyway. I think it has a chance. So that's all we're talking about that's been damaged so far.
Can we starve them out? I mean, they've got to find food or they're going to starve. Can we starve them out?
Well, if we wrap all the trees and they have nothing to eat, eventually, yeah. But I think...
What do they eat? They eat the bark?
They eat the cambium layer, which is just beneath the outer bark. That's their preferred food.
So just trees is what they eat?
No. During the nice summer seasons, the spring, when we get aquatic vegetation, they'll eat duckweed, they'll eat algae, they'll eat pond lilies, so they'll eat any kind of vegetative stuff. So it's usually around this time of year they turn their diet and their focus towards trees.
So, Vicki, if we put the flow device in, and then I know there are certain plants that they're more prone to eat, like willows and things like that. If we were to put the flow device in and provide them with a preferred food source?
That would help. It would get them through the winter. The other thing they're eating right now is corn. They're going into the cornfield that's right by the ditch.
Well, and they are just north of us in Clark County, up the other end of that ditch too. So
yeah, there are a lot of beaver here, and I, you know, if you look at the history of beaver populations and how they grow and how they shrink and how they level off, I think it's just something we have to deal with. We have to wrap trees. We have to have them look unsightly for a short while until the beavers sort of mellow out.
So if someone were wanting to volunteer to help with wrapping the trees, right now they should get in touch with you or perhaps Mary Ann to assist you with that. And So the long-term solution would be wrap the trees, put the flow device in, and perhaps provide an alternative food source.
That would probably be ideal, yeah.
And again, as I stated, if the county decides that they're going to come in and trap and eliminate these beavers, the county has every right to do that because they're in the drainage ditch that the county maintains.
I'm expecting that to be the solution.
I had a question about the, do you know when the county's coming?
I don't, and now that the drainage has been somewhat restored.
It hasn't been. I don't know. I was out there right before this meeting.
Okay, well, they...
And it, somebody moved about 6 inches.
Well, they're supposed to let me know this week when they're going to have a contractor in to remove the dam.
Okay.
I mean, that's what they're talking about now is removing the dam.
But if they remove the dam, won't the beavers...
The beavers will just cut down more trees.
They'll be stimulated to cut more trees.
Yeah, I don't think that...
The county understands that, but they're concerned that the drainage into the farm fields is getting to the point where they have to do something.
But if we say we're going to, are we offering to put a flow device in? The village?
Yeah.
We are, but it's not going to happen fast enough for the county. I mean...
Well, it depends when they're... If the county told you we have 5 days until they're going to rip the dam out, we could get a flow device together, and as they rip the dam out, we could stick it in.
Right, and I agree with that, but yeah. I don't know when they're going to do that.
Right.
So Jason's already working on gathering the materials.
Okay.
So will they only eat live trees?
Pretty much, yeah.
Because I see an awful lot of firewood sitting around. And yeah. They won't eat it
because, it doesn't have any nutrition. But, I mean, if you cut branches off a tree, like we trimmed a lot of the trees out there and we piled the branches up, they took all of them.
Tell about the family. I heard there's a family.
There's a family out there. It's a mom and dad, 2 babies. I saw them all last night. 2 babies and 2 yearlings. And the yearlings are from last year's litter. They're still there. Usually the yearlings leave sometime during their second year, but they haven't left yet, and they kind of babysit the babies. But the yearlings, typically, their second year disperse and go off. But with this many beaver in the area, it's harder and harder for them to find places to stay. So they sort of self-regulate their populations.
So they stop having babies?
They stop. Yeah, their litter size goes up to 88, but they usually only have 2 when they run out of food and it gets too crowded and so forth.
Okay. Well, I guess we're wrapping trees and waiting to see what the county says and waiting to see how patient our tree committee is going to be, I'm suspecting.
Thank you.
Trees take a lot longer to grow than a beaver does. Mm-hmm. So it's really a concern. And the other concern I have right now is whether we should even try to replace some of the trees that were taken.
I agree on that.
I think so too.
Why don't you plant some willow?
We have some willows over in Ellis along the pond.
Those are the only ones the beavers have found.
Yes.
There's 3 willow trees.
And some of those are tribute trees, and oh my gosh, it's just no fun at all listening to people cry about their lost trees.
Wow. So. Okay.
Whatever we can do.
Well, obviously, I mean, this is not going to be an easy solution, I have a feeling.
One thing I was going to say, just since we're talking about trees, is the Energy Board is thinking about ways to, thinking about reducing energy use. And one of the most cooling things in the summer are trees. And in fact, Columbus a few years ago, the city of Columbus, planted a huge number of trees as a climate action, part of a climate action plan. I don't think they called it that. But just to say, that's something I'm interested in us thinking about.
You might be interested in knowing that we're considering planting a forest at the AX Park, when that is the intersection of Xenia Avenue and Allen Street. There's an area there that Jason Hamby says the soil is very wet. They don't mow it because it's so spongy.
Yeah.
So we're thinking of putting a whole forest of trees in there.
Oh, nice.
That would be great.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Cool.
And you may know also that, heck, in 2007, there was an inventory done of village trees here. The tree committee has planted about 2,000 trees in this village, not more. And we turned the information over to the Extension Office at Ohio State, and they sent back a report of the value of the trees for a lot of different things, and it was in a huge amount of value. So you're absolutely right. We need to, the more trees we can plant, the better.
Yeah. And it's something when you, I feel like we should be talking about in the newspaper or whatever, you know, when people cut down trees that are near their home and provide shade and the impact. I think sometimes people don't think about the impacts of.
Oh, no, they don't.
Of that. So, till this tree's down and then it's really hot.
Yeah, but, you know, as our trees grow, at least in my area, they're very hot. Do get struck by light.
Yeah. Well, so, there's the, you know, yeah, they have to be.
One of the problems we have here in Yellow Springs is the bedrock is so close to the surface, and that interferes with a lot of trees, different types of trees growing. So we have to be real careful about what we put.
That's right.
Okay. Thank you. Let's take our break and come back and do the budget.
Very interesting meeting. Trees, beavers.
Okay, are we ready to come back into session?
Yes.
So the last thing on the agenda, well, the last thing on in old business is the budget workshop. It's the collective budget and revisions. Melissa did a great job. She has a beginning piece that kind of goes through all of the changes to the budget, so I'll just turn it over to her and let her briefly go through the budget.
Okay, so what was included in the packet was all of the budgets resubmitted in the same format that you had all seen previously. We have the general fund budget, we have special revenue funds budget, we have capital projects and debt service funds budget, and then we have the enterprise funds budget. And then we also have the capital budget, which is a list of all of the projects for 17 through 2021. And then there are two new documents, which you haven't seen before, which I thought would be helpful. The first one is 2017 budget changes. So this goes through everything that I had changed as a result of either the presentations that were part of the meetings, and there were just a few things that were put in there that were kind of last minute updates. So I'm going to go through the changes, and then I'm going to talk about some of the fund balances, which is the second document that was included that council has not seen before in the budget presentations. So with the 2017 budget changes, what I did was I went through and categorized them by funds. So the first one, we have the general fund. And one of the first things was there was a question about why are the property taxes so much higher? So I had sent that question over to the auditor, and the auditor had sent me back a response saying, well, your property taxes are actually just the same. It's just they were distributed differently this year between the real estate tax line, which we see in our revenues, and that's under the local tax category, and the rollback and homestead line, which is under the state shared taxes and permits. So the total figure is the same between 2016 and what we'd received and what we are expected to receive in 2017. The distribution was different, so that kind of threw me for a loop until he pointed that out. So I redistributed it as it should be, but I might need to tweak that if it would happen to come in differently. I'm not real sure why it came in distributed differently in 2016 than what it has any year previous to that. So I did adjust those figures. So the revenues for the real estate taxes are 987, I'm sorry, not 987, I'm looking at the old budget, $863,625 per the tax budget, and then the rollback in homestead is $123,375. So both of those figures were included in the tax budget, And it just looks different because, like I just explained, it's because it was distributed differently in 2016. So that was one change that was made. That was the only change to revenues. The others were expenditures. A question was brought up about books and publications in council, and the original expense wasn't charged correctly, so I did make a correction to the expenditures for 2016, so it resulted in a zero net effect. So I just distributed that as it should. The auditor, I actually decreased the contract amount because there was a formula in there that had it increasing to $13,000 in a previous version, and I dropped that back down to the contract price of $9,000, which is accurate. Cable. With personnel services, what we did was, I don't know, Patty, if you were going to speak to the change that was proposed.
Yes.
Okay. Do you want to go ahead and do that, since that was a change that I had to make to the budget?
Sure. Brian and I met with Susan to get an update on the Channel 5 and the station management. That's part of her contract, is that we do that once a year. And as I explained to Susan, because of some wage and hour law changes, we need to make Susan an employee, a part-time employee, as opposed to an independent contractor. Nothing will really change for Susan other than the fact that she will become a village employee and therefore will have to put into OPRS and workers' comp, and will deduct her taxes instead of her having to pay them herself, et cetera. So one of the things that we talked to Susan about was a potential increase in pay, and that is what you see reflected in the amount for her personnel services when they go into that line instead of as an independent contractor.
That's not in addition to...
No, it's an increase over what she makes now, but it's not in addition to what she makes now, if that's what you're asking.
So basically what I did in terms of the budget was I took the money out of the professional services line, which was under the contractual services category, and I moved it up to personnel services. So there was it wasn't the same number that came out that went into personal services, because we had to account for the OPRS and the workers' comp and things like that. So it is a little bit more than what it was before. Okay, and then the HRC department, what had been done as a result of council's request was I retitled that council commissions. Apparently at the bottom of that line, I did not update the bottom where it says total, but I will do that. So I renamed the HRC budget council commissions budget, and I marked that budget at $25,000. So the way that I distributed that was I put $5,000 in general operating expenses, which is basically travel and training, $10,000 to contractual services, and $10,000 to materials and supplies. Those numbers can be moved around any way that we see fit throughout the year. I can move those without any type of council action. So those were just where I kind of set those to begin with, and then we can take a look at that as the year progresses to see where those funds are actually needed. Planning, there were two changes there. A part-time seasonal person was added into personnel services for $11,000. And then also in professional services, which you'll see this same expense repeated in the enterprise funds, is an added share of GIS labor. We have a lot of things that still need to be GIS'd within the village. And so planning, electric, water distribution, and sewer collection are all going to share that expense. So that is for the electric department's actually going to purchase the equipment, but the other four departments are all going to split the labor at $5,000 a piece for a total cost of $25,000.
Patty, I assume that personnel, that part-time seasonal, is to do inspections and things?
Yeah, it's
maintenance.
It's to assist Denise during the growing season when she's got the high grass inspections and the vegetation complaints and that kind of thing, to help maybe process some of the lesser permits, like maybe a fence or something, do the, you know, the groundwork on those so that she can just review them for final approval.
Okay.
Maybe go out and inspect the sites and make sure that they're, you know, putting their fence in the proper place, et cetera. Things that Denise really has very little time for now. Denise is supposed to work 30 hours a week, and she never makes it at 30 hours a week. And she's always got at least 3 hours of overtime.
Mm-hmm.
And I shouldn't say overtime because it's still straight time because it's not 40 hours. But this would really ease her burden, especially during the summer when she has all of the larger construction projects, conditional use permits, all of those things that take all that mm-hmm. extra time.
Okay.
And so similarly for the GIS labor, that is our staff?
That's going to be contracted.
Contracted?
Mm-hmm, correct.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And I know that Denise has organized that, so I don't know exactly who that's going to be through or anything, but
yeah,
I know that it's contracted out.
Yeah,
though.
Okay. It's Rob Bondurant.
Okay.
And then the final change as it relates to the general fund is I increased all of the transfers to the capital equipment or the capital funds. I put the green space back at $25,000 as opposed to the original $5,000 that was earmarked. Capital equipment, facilities improvement, and parks and rec improvement were all increased as well at $25,000 apiece. And that's half of what had been transferred into those three respective funds in 2016. So again, with the transfers, I knew that was going to be a point of discussion with the budget tonight, especially once we're able to see where everything falls. So if I don't know if you guys want to discuss any of that now, or if you want me to get through the few other changes across the other funds, it's up to you.
Let's go ahead and finish it.
Okay. Special revenue funds, the only thing that was changed out of there was streets. The new truck was approved for sewer collection and streets, so you have $22,000 coming out of streets, and then if you look down at sewer collection, that's not on the list, but it was in the budget, so I will put half of new truck down there on that list, but I did put it in the budget. Then if we go to the capital and debt service budgets, those reflect the transfers in because you have to have the revenue accounted for as well. And then the enterprise funds, again, this GIS equipment and labor, electric was taking the equipment share of that at $5,000, as well as the $5,000 for labor, and then water and water distribution, sewer collection, we're each taking $5,000 for that labor mm-hmm. for the same project. And then the other thing that came up, I know that I had mentioned this when we were discussing changing the utility billing software, the fact that we were going to need a new server in order to be able to support that. We were trying to get figures, and of course with tech advisors coming in, they did a whole assessment of our infrastructure for hardware, and even when they put in their bid, they had told us up front, along with a few of the other companies that put in bids, that our servers were going to need to be addressed sooner rather than later. So we were very much aware of that. So in getting the pricing for the new server that would service the utilities, they also got some pricing in order to upgrade the servers that would support our entire computer infrastructure for the village. So that total was going to be $75,000, and that was split amongst 12 departments, and that's $6,250 each department share.
And
so those were the major changes, and I don't know if Patty has anything to add with the servers. I know that
yeah.
was kind of added in, but we literally just got that figure last week, so
yeah. Actually, I met with both Bartley Davis and Randall East of Tech Advisors. Chief was there for part of the meeting because Part of the problem is the police department servers started to literally fail on us because they were in such bad shape, and right now we're actually running off of two borrowed servers from Tech Advisors that they happen to have two older servers. The actual cost for the servers is likely to be less than the $75,000. The two servers themselves will cost, I think it was $55,000. We have three quotes, but one quote was from Maveca to do it as a virtual server. That one was actually a continuing cost of $20,000 per year, so it didn't really make sense to do that when we could, in fact, just buy new servers. Another one was from Your Store, which is the one that we will probably accept because it was the lowest, and it is at $62,672, and then one from Tech Advisors themselves, which was $66,534. So in addition to the actual servers, we have a cabinet to house the wiring that needs to be contained. The good thing about these servers is that they will let us migrate to a virtual environment so that we can actually just kind of keep expanding them, and we won't have to upgrade them again anytime soon.
So do you have an idea of how long they do last?
But what did he say during that? Did he say five?
I think they're expected at least 6 years, five, 6 years.
So I would like to draw everyone's attention to the document that's titled Village of Yellow Springs History of Major Fund Balances. And this basically shows the beginning and ending fund balances and what the end of year difference was historically back to 2010, and then what is projected for 2016 and then 2017. So if we just focus in on 2017, those numbers will show, the numbers out to the far right will show where I predict that we will end the year if the budget goes as planned. All of the funds, which I have the major ones, the general fund, the electric, water, sewer, and solid waste fund, all of the funds are projected to be in the black at this point, except for the general fund. It's expected to go into the red by approximately $33,000. I don't necessarily think that that's what's going to happen. If you look back at the last few budgets that I've presented to council, by the end of the year, the deficits were much less than what were projected because of my conservative approach. So $33,000 isn't really that much, and I really don't realistically expect that to occur unless something unforeseen could happen. So if all goes as planned and is on paper as it is, I expect that we will probably have some cost savings as we usually do, and revenues will probably be a little bit more than what I've braced for as well. So I don't expect the deficit to be significant by any means. So with that being said, those are the major highlights. We can go into as much depth as anybody wishes to should they have any questions, but those are the highlights.
Melissa, excuse me, I have a question, and I thought I saw it, and I'm looking, I can't find it. What is the balance in the green space fund?
$195,000.
So with the extra $25,000, though, what's it? Then that takes it up to $220,000.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Everything that we saw in the capital budget's the same?
Yes, everything in the capital budget is the same with the exception of the truck.
Right.
And it was already in there, it's just the figures slid over a year.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, and there was one thing that I would like to just point out. There was an article that covered the budget in the Yellow Springs News just last week, and there was a portion of the article that discussed the remote water meters, which are earmarked at $700,000, which we will be taking a loan out for. And it was quoted that we had already had some of the meters and that they were installed, but we do not. We haven't purchased any of them yet, so. But that will be a loan.
I have a question. When we've got, we've probably got that amount in the electric fund. And we could almost take that amount out without going below our minimum.
They're water meters.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. The electric meters we did replace and we were able to take out, but the water meters are much more expensive, so.
Okay. Any other comments or questions? So with the next meeting, this will come to us in the form of an ordinance?
Correct.
When should we discuss, so we're going to do this, and then we're going to have a discussion with Krista about the Green Space Fund at some point to the future, and we might decide to do something additional.
We can move money from one if we decide from one account? Okay.
Yeah, what I normally do is we have a transfer ordinance that we have to do anytime we move money, so I typically do that right around the beginning of the year. So, I mean, we could do that at some point in December if, you know, there's still discussion in that regard. So usually I try to present it, you know, around the first of the year so that I can move the money right away.
Okay, we're ready to move on. Manager's report.
All right. Council remembers that at the last meeting we talked about starting the team building process, and I have been in touch with Professor Brenda Craner at Wright State, and in fact I'm meeting with her tomorrow to start my part of that team building. The cable access channel, Susan is doing a great job, and I would just like to thank her for that. She's very diligent in her duties. And as we discussed a little earlier, we do need to move Susan from being a contractor to being a part-time employee. So if council is in agreement with that, I will prepare the position description in the resolution to create that position for the next meeting.
Yeah, I think.
Okay. Okay, enclosed you find a memo from Chief Hale regarding a third sergeant's position in the police department. The administrative code specifically notes that the police department can have a chief, a captain, and two sergeants. What we'd like to do is change the wording to allow him the ability to make three sergeants, or if the need arises later, a captain, but to keep it at three supervisory besides himself. His immediate plan is to create a third sergeant position to fill in an empty supervisory slot that will help always have a sergeant here on the weekends. Right now we don't have a sergeant here Friday, Saturday, or Sunday. So Chief, would you like to say anything in addition to that?
You hit it all in a can of blood.
Does anyone have any questions about it? I mean, I'm sure you do. I just don't know what they are.
Well, I guess I just wanted to understand. I mean, I read the memo. Mm-hmm. Is a decision being made by us at this point in time? Because I feel like it's a piece that maybe should be on our agenda to, you know, have.
Well, we can discuss it. I mean, we would like to move forward with it simply because we want that third sergeant to also be part of this team building exercise that we're getting ready to do. And Chief would have to give a promotional examination and go through an interview process for this promotion, just like for any other promotion. So it will take some time to put it into effect. And I don't want to proceed with the larger team building efforts without that person in place if we're going to do it, because that doesn't make sense to me to have the other two sergeants participate and not that person.
It feels like a big decision to me that I feel like should be on the agenda, in a place on the agenda where citizens could participate if they were interested. Mm-hmm. That's the only thing. When these things come right at the end of the meeting, I feel like that's you know, it seems like an important decision to me.
In the past, have we opened up, when we have sergeants and so forth, do we have public discussions on those?
I've never been here when we've promoted a sergeant, so I can't answer that directly. I will point out that it is going to be a piece of legislation, it'd be an ordinance that gets two public readings, because it's part of the administrative code, therefore it has to be an ordinance to change it. Normally, that kind of thing, if you, in the charter, is left to myself or the chief to decide who gets the promotion. This is simply changing the wording to, instead of being a captain and two sergeants, to be three supervisors of the rank sergeant or above.
Okay, I didn't really understand that.
Yeah, I mean, it's just.
I thought we were adding a third person at a higher level.
It allows for three supervisors. Right now, it just specifically says two sergeants and a captain.
I see.
We just want to make it three supervisors, rank of sergeant or above. And the immediate intent is to promote a third sergeant.
So it's not a big change, it's just.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Okay.
Well, also, it seemed like you were saying that there was going to be one less officer.
Yes, with, when we pulled the detective out of the task force, prior to that, we had adequate staffing. So when you pull them out, I have above adequate staffing. And one of the tenets of it is that most places, you end up with like 10 to 16% differential between top line patrol officer, first line supervision, second line supervision. The administrative code has that here at 3%, which is extremely small for the responsibility they take on. So what I'm hoping to do is barter the loss of that position, which saves the village about $85,000, to the raises, which would cost the village about $15,000.
Well, I appreciated everything you wrote. I felt like I pretty much understood it and appreciated that you were making those, that you want to make those changes, and I support.
Yeah, since I've been here, I've loved to have three supervisors. You know, we end up with a relatively young department, and I believe now I have at least two people who have more than 2 years on who would be interested in those positions, who would do a good job if either of them got them, there maybe even a third candidate. So, and then that would provide a supervisor here every day of the week. Even if one took off, there would be, because there would be one in the day, one in the evening, there would always be one that would have some responsibility.
The another point that you made that I appreciated was that by having this other position, it encourages people maybe to stay longer in the department. And as you noted, this is something that we want in the community, for people to stay longer so they know the community.
It makes my job a lot easier also. So yes, yeah. You know, longevity is a good thing for me also.
Plus the coverage on, you know, we don't have that sergeant coverage at our busiest time.
Yeah, well, and police work is one of those strange things where you never know when busy is.
Right. But with the tourism and so forth that we have on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday.
Yes, and that's predominantly the staffing level. Your coverage, you will not see anything different.
Right.
In the mornings, these sergeants would start an hour later, but the call volume from 7 in the morning to 8 in the morning is fairly negligible, so you won't notice the difference.
Yeah, thanks explaining,
Dave.
It.
So it sounds like just bring that legislation to the next meeting, Patty.
Okay, so there will be two pieces of legislation, the one to change it to a third sergeant and the other one to change the pay differential. Mm-hmm. The Welcome Back Art Show. We've been trying to get this together. It came with I'm going to call it a recommendation from Arts and Culture Commission, because you don't really have a quorum. So, but it started out as a multi-artist show, and now it's down to a one-person show, but it is Aaron Smith. And your pictures, some of them I don't think maybe copied very well. If they didn't, I have originals here that I printed off from what she sent me, and there are some of them in color, so that might be helpful. But it is Aaron Smith. As you can see, She's an assistant professor of art at Central State, and I think she's very excited to do this show. So if council is in agreement, I will hopefully get the lease agreement, the exhibit agreement from Chris, and we can get moving with that for Aaron. So I'll give you a minute to look at the photos. Again, the only other two things I have is that Trick or Treat is the 31st from 6 to 8, and the Planning and Zoning Office will be closed for most of the month of December as Denise takes a well-deserved break.
But I assume that there will be somebody that will be taking things. Okay.
That would be me.
So if something came forward.
Yeah, if something urgent came forward that needed to be done, I would take care of it.
Okay. Sounds good. Melissa? Well, let's yeah. Go on with the reports and then come back to that. Melissa?
Okay. Basically, in my report, I just went over some of the things that were already discussed in the packet. The only other thing that was new that I'd like to add that kind of came in late in the game at the end of last week was there was a resolution a meeting or two ago for a grant proposal request to the MVRPC for sidewalk ramps that council supported. So the MVRPC released a summary of the application. So ours is one of 15 projects up for consideration, so that's a fairly small pool. And ours is the smallest amount requested, so we're hopeful. So there's a meeting coming up where they're going to go over all of the proposals, so we're hopefully going to have a good shot, I hope. So positive thoughts towards that. But that's it for me.
Great. Judy, and then we'll come back to the art show.
Yeah, just you've got proof of a couple of trainings. You guys are covered for your Sunshine Law training, although, of course, I encourage you to take it whenever you feel the need, and we managed to slaughter any number of stink bugs, so I think the invasion's over for 2016 again.
There is one in the hall.
You're talking about my office, you're going to take care of yourself.
Any comments or questions about the art exhibit? I guess we would need do we want a motion to approve it?
So moved.
Is that the next step?
Second.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye. Just real quick, Judy, I mean, has something changed with Sunshine Law?
No.
Okay. All right, because I've done it. So.
No, it's, I mean, the year that you get elected, even if you're reelected, you have to take it within that first year, uh-huh. any time that you're elected. And so you're covered, and it makes it a lot easier when the auditor says, okay, where is everyone's certification mm-hmm. for me to just go here instead of having to pull from people's separate mm-hmm. files. So it just makes it simpler.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
Okay, moving on to commission reports. Jerry.
I was late for the meeting, so I'm on that the part that I was involved in. We talked a little bit more about the Airbnb. And I think that was it, because the meeting was very short. but we did start early at 4:30, I think it was. I'll let Judy talk to that early portion.
There were two text amendments passed that were very simple, just changes to something that had been approved and okayed in one spot, and we missed a place that it needed to be carried over so that things were, even across the zoning code. That was very simple. Environmental Commission brought their recommendation for the ordinance change for the lawn mowing ordinance. That opened up a discussion because that ordinance currently is extremely unclear and, in fact, only asks that folks mow the perimeter of their lawn after July 1st. So it was, in fact, sent back to Environmental Commission, and they were just asked, can you clarify this and make this a really something that the PD can use more readily? So they've got that in hand. They'll bring it back to Planning Commission. Planning Commission knows that will be a lively discussion.
And that's who's responsible is the PD? for...
To enforce, yeah. Ultimately, it's in the enforcement chapter, so planning, the zoning administrator, you know, sends a letter saying, you know, you've done this or that, but PD's often gets called out for a neighbor dispute. They're not mowing their lawn, and then PD has to contact the zoning administrator. It tends to go around that way. The greater the amount of clarity, the simpler it is for everyone involved, and right now it is not very clearly written.
And even though Mary Ann is not the alternate, she was at the meeting also. Did you want to add anything to what we said?
Well, I think EC is going to decide two things. I think will EC recommend that people need to mow their whole lawn? That's one question. And the other question is, what's the height limit? Right now it's 12 inches, so. That's it.
Okay, thank you.
And the budget part, we heard since we've been in the budget review.
Brian?
I think CR can come off of the updates at this point. Economic Sustainability Commission, Karen will talk about that because I was not able to attend that meeting. Community Access Panel still on hiatus. Arts and Culture Commission, actually a very cool announcement. We are awarding the fourth VITA, Village Inspiration and Design Award, and we've been excited to do this one for a while. It's going to Katie Seidel and Beth Holyoke. And actually, it is coming up soon, the ceremony. It's going to be this Sunday, the 23rd at 3 p.m., and we're doing it at the Spring Sign on Danielle Springs Road. And so that is where we are proposing that the VITA traveling trophy lives for a period of time.
What time Sunday?
3 p.m. And this should be in the Yellow Springs News because a press release was put together for that. I think it goes without saying that Beth and Katie have certainly enhanced the village in many ways. The art cans, the benches, and I think if you look at the history of the VITA, it's had a nice variety of, you know, more traditional artists and also folks that are just beautifying their space. So hope everybody can make it. And otherwise, the Arts and Culture Commission has been trying to dig a little bit deeper on some of the things related to the Bryan Center Gallery just to help support. But I like that we are finally bringing art back to the Bryan Center, and I think some of the things like the contracts and whatnot will be worked out with this first show that's coming back.
Great, thanks. Judith?
The Energy Board, we talked about the ideas about helping citizens reduce utilities. We came up with a list of ideas. And we're going to take those to the Climate Action Meeting. We also talked at length, we've been kind of talking about this for a while, about people who have solar arrays and how when they have created enough energy to get them through the winter, the village is required by the auditor to clear that what's kind of a debt to those solar people off the books at the end of the year, so then they would have that energy to use through the winter. So it's, I'm not sure that we've, Patty's working on it with Melissa, and I'm not sure what's happening with that, but there's a hope that there would be a way not to have to erase that off their accounts, because it would potentially get them through the winter, and then solar, you know, the sun starts, you know, gets warm over the summer and they start creating more energy. So anyway, the Library Commission, I missed the meeting. I totally spaced it. So you were there, Patty.
Yes, Jason and his crew are still working on some of the improvements to the library. They have replaced the ceiling tiles that were damaged, had some water damage. They still have a few to put in, but mostly they're in.
We are planning on putting the new handrails around the outside next year. That was in the capital budget. I'm sure you saw that. And other than that, we are still just working on trying to get the capital budget back where it needs to be in order to do the remaining larger improvements, which are the windows on the south-facing wall and the bathroom remodel.
And then the justice system task.
Can I ask one question?
Yeah.
Did we ever come up with a solution for the equipment that was the air conditioning?
Oh, the air conditioning unit. Yeah. We put a watchdog system on it, which if somebody cuts the wire, it blares an alarm. It doesn't keep people from climbing on it or anything like that, but it does give an alert if somebody tries to interrupt the service in some way.
And the Justice System Task Force had its second meeting. Pat DeWeese has a lot of experience helping groups develop work plans, and that's what we're working on right now. It was a very good discussion. We're looking at kind of splitting. There's going to be work groups are being organized, looking at the mayor's court, the police department, and it was an excellent meeting, I thought. And we are, it is on DVD if anybody's interested to watch it. And Patty and the chief are getting a copy of that, and the mayor also. So,
thank you, Mary Ann. The mediation program did not meet between our last meeting, our last month and this month. And I did not meet with Steve Kahn, but with the school board. The Human Relations Commission met. Josh Knapp was the police officer that came, and that was a fun time with him, talking about himself. And there weren't a lot of citizens there, but there were some citizens there. Also, Summer came and gave pretty much the same presentation that she gave to us, and we talked about that. HRC, I think, awarded two grants, both for programs in the schools. And we are going to be sending a letter to Pastor Randolph in regard to the letter that they sent to us. That hasn't happened yet, so.
What were the grants?
Ninja, is it self-defense training for girls? Mm-hmm. And another thing that the 365 and people do. John Gudgel. John Gudgel coming to HRC for program. And Kate Hamilton's involved in more. So. Okay, EC. Well, we talked about the climate action planning for the climate action plan. Talked about the source water protection plan, which is what it's now, used to be called the Wellhead Protection Plan, called the Source Water Protection Plan, and where that stands. We're hoping that Sarah Hippensteel will be on the commission to replace Jessica D'Ambrosio.
That's great.
I mean, she has indicated an interest.
Good.
So those are the main things that we talked about.
Okay.
And we've already pretty much, I think, covered the Beaver Management Task Force.
Economic Sustainability Commission, we're just continuing to talk about an incentive, how to develop incentives for economic development and potentially for other village expenditures and the revolving loan fund. There's a lot of work going on in small group and less than quorum groups. That's proving pretty good, but what they've also kind of come around to is that there are existing documents that really are probably just as easy to modify and use those as instead of just reinventing the wheel. So that's the direction that's going. Green County Regional Planning, the growth that's happening in Sugar Creek Township is obscene. But basically what's happening is that people are coming to them, they want to be on a particular piece of property that's in Sugar Creek Township, and Sugar Creek Township is essentially letting them do what they want or they're going to go and be annexed. They'll say, well, we'll just go to Centerville and be annexed, which is exactly what happened with the Cornerstone development. So Sugar Creek Township is essentially being blackmailed to allow, I think they've got 800 rental units going into that community, along with a couple hundred houses. I mean, it's just the growth, but it's most of the growth is right around the Wilmington Pike area by the new Cornerstone development. Let's see, Miami Valley Regional Planning Commission, I think our last meeting might have been 15 minutes. So that was about, they're going back, a group that has specific interests led by Miami Valley Regional Planning Commission leadership and led by folks from Beaver Creek are going back to the state to make the case for the money that they need for the Route 35 project. And that is, they're listed like one and two. There's work on Route 35 in Dayton around the Woodman Road area or Woodman Drive area. And then the Beaver Creek project is another project. So those are like one and two on the state list of ODOT projects. Chamber, we've got a chamber chat this Thursday, October 20th, 9 a.m. here in A and B. And we're going to be talking about the new overtime regulation, which I think is probably going to impact a lot more people than they really understand. Anybody that's making more than or less than $47,400 and some dollars salaried are going to be eligible for overtime pay. So, and we're also going to have Schuler's donut holes, pumpkin donut holes.
Wow.
So, at the meeting. So, that's the incentive for attending. Okay, future agenda items. So, we've got the budget. Don't we have a second reading of something? Well, we've got the two. So we've got we've got the two things for Chief.
Mm-hmm. And the position ordinance for Susan.
And that's an ordinance? Mm,
yes, that's what Judy says.
Oh, for Susan, I thought you were talking about the Chief.
No.
But yeah, if you're adding position, I think you need an ordinance.
Yeah. I mean, we used to have a station manager.
You have to repeal the old language in the code. Therefore, it has to be an ordinance
for the Chief.
Right, that we knew. But
we're talking about Susan's position.
Just check and see, because there used to be a paid station manager, so it may already be there. But one way or the other, we need legislation.
Right.
Okay. Let's see, was there something else that was being talked about?
Get the treasurer.
Oh, yeah, treasurer. Mm-hmm.
That'll come.
And then several things came up at this meeting. So I guess there's the issue of the letter or resolution related to what Don
right.
brought up. Indigenous people, People's Day, and then discussing the CBE land forum.
Well, I guess I'm, if, we'll see. I mean, I guess.
I'm not saying we're doing them all
right.
the next meeting, but.
Yeah, because if economic sustainability is just now getting that assignment, I'm not sure that they're going to be able to have something to bring back to council after one discussion. Okay, okay. And what was the status of the indigenous people? That was in HRC's hands, right?
Hand.
Okay. Okay. Motion to adjourn.
I so move.
All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye.